away. It's Gino's spot. Sit down now. Get yourself a drink. Sit down, relax. Let your stresses fade away. We're nearly ready for you. We just fiddle around behind the stage. Just fiddle backstage with the buttons. Don't you step into the circle, you feel.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
Down, coming out of PE town. Drink, find a shark. Never mind your liver. Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Have a laugh, have a giggle, and exercise your middle. Have a Gino shot.
Gino's shot.
Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Have a laugh, have a giggle, and exercise your middle. Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Gino's Spot. Indeed, it's Tuesday night, and ready. We are ready to chat again on our PE Klebegeni show. Indeed, our community, our Eastern Cape community, is being brought together. That's what we're trying to do here. Joker Def ZA says, "How's it? Anybody work here? Please turn on the caption. I'm deaf. He's my grandpa." There we go. We can try now. I think that the caption should be coming on now. The captions should be on. Let me know. I think you can turn it on your Facebook if you need to stick on the captions. I think they're automatic. And fantastic, Brian Wilkinson. I see you there as well. And I see Charles Jacobs. I see. Oh, there we go. Brian, good evening, Gina. Good evening to you as well. And Charles Jacobs, how's it to Charles Aubrey Jacobs? Lovely to have you on board. Ronald Menor, lovely. I'm so glad you woke up again. Morning, Gino. 4 a.m. for a nice, fresh Wellington start. That's all the way from the New Zealand. It's the Zealand that was new now, not the old one. Carol Jacobs, all the way from Arena Events there in East London. Fantastic to have you on. I haven't seen you for a while, Carol. Lovely. And Camilla Ellis. Camilla Ellis is making her entrance as well tonight. Fantastic. A lot of you guys watching on YouTube and Facebook. If you haven't clicked on the YouTube to subscribe, please do it, because YouTube is the best way to watch Gino Spot every Tuesday and Thursday, except for next week, which is going to be a Wednesday live, but we will rebroadcast on Thursday because we have a little jiggy gig on. There we go. Subscribe. We've used pink, I suppose. Girl power. This one. And next week, of course, we've also got John Rushmere coming on next week as well, which is going to be actually this week. On Thursday we've got John Rushmere coming on. He's going to be talking about architecture and his life of sport and Lord knows else what else as well. We're going to chat about everything. David, how's it, David Rodocanachi? He was Matric 88, VP 88. We got a couple of oaks on here from VP 88, David, so check it out. I think sometimes Monique Besson comes on as well. Somebody tag Monique. And Alvin Reeves is also, he pops on every now and again. So please tag Alvin. You can say how's it to your old classmates. 84 to 88 at VP. It was a fantastic time. I really enjoyed my school. Internet probably in problems here this morning in New Zealand. I cannot believe it, Ronald Menor. Our internet seems to be going okay. Touch wood, and we're ready to go with the show. Indeed, Gino Spot. Thank you to Spa. Thank you to Spa, our sponsors, Spa and Fitch and Leeds as well, which will be giving away a case of Fitch and Leeds. So stick around because you can win an entire case of Fitch and Leeds, which you can drink to your and have fun all night drinking gin and tonics with Fitch and Leeds, and also our internet with Amobia as well. Amobia, thank you so much for our internet. And we have Fat Cats has provided a bit of food here. If you can see, a little bit of seafood coming on here as well. We've got tonight's special Fat Cats catering. Thank you, Grace. You've been such a legend. Lovely jubbly. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, I think it is pretty much time to start. Just sing a song for you guys. Tell me where you are. I've got my little Fitch and Leeds here and a little bit of punters. We're having a bit of gin and tonic, a grizzling, a colo. I just can't handle it, this thing. Sean Sullivan says hello, Gino. Yes, I say hello back. Jean-Claude Spitz is there. Oh! Great, Facebook have captions. So watch here. Hi, everybody. Hi, Jean-Claude Spitz. And Claudel Spitz is watching from the bedroom. Hello, my dad. He's watching on YouTube. Oh, good. Yeah. A crazy thing. A baby. She knows how to rock and roll. And Alan Carter. And Brian Wilkinson. He used to work at the Boardwalk Beater. Subscribe. Subscribe to YouTube. Colo. I just can't hide from him. This thing. Colo. I just can't handle it. Happy, happy. Here we go again. That's right. Camilla Ellis. She said her favorite dog song, cause he loves to do the twist. I'd like to see that baby post a picture. Alright, Camilla Ellis was also MVP, I think she was. Oh yes. You gotta be cool, relaxed. Went in, I got all my tracks in the backseat. A hitchhike. Take a long ride on my motorbike until I'm ready.
Ready, Freddy.
A crazy little thing, cola. Oh, crazy thing, a cola. Billy Ellis is back and also Claudel. Come wait, see my dad, George Rodocanachi on this live thing. Oh yeah, awesome. Rendo Peel is watching too. Rendo's audio. That's where Ray works. Ray is George's son. And Camilla is, yes, of course, a glass of 90. I like that indeed. Oh, a glass of 90. I'm thinking of a glass of 90. It's class of 90. That was, I don't know if Ray was possibly class of, no, he's a little younger. A couple of Rodokanakis there at VP. I know David was with me, 88, but Ray was a little younger than us, you know. Although he looks like he's taller than us. Well, ladies and gentlemen, fantastic to have you all on. We're going to be talking fishing tonight for sure. And I'm not a big fisherman, but I'd like to learn tonight, because we have one of the legends of fishing. And I am going to call on his son just to do an introduction. But let's have our introductory video. Let's do it.
Welcome to the show. Now is your time to shine. We're gonna have a lucky chat tonight.
Another good time.
And welcome, Ray. We've got you in quickly, because you know you're giving your dad some things, but XVP and you know, yep. Rendo's audio working soul sapping day there today as well. It was
what we got to do, eh?
You know,
you're gonna,
it is. And I see Rendo's online. How's it, Rendo?
Hey, boss.
I bought that amp. I've still got that amp. I bought an amp from Rendo. It's fantastic, and it's been working like a bomb ever since. I got it on my, you know, on my phone. Mm-hmm. You do that
Bluetooth.
Stuff. Bluetooth. That's it, and on my Wi-Fi, which I love. I love automation stuff like that. But Ray, I thought I'd bring you on because you've all your life has been with your dad, mm-hmm. and I'm sure you sort of came out the womb with a fishing rod in your hand. Just about.
Well, I don't know if I came out with one, but there's one waiting when I got out. Yeah.
So Ray, I don't know if there's any way that you can introduce your dad. I mean, how would you do it?
Well, what can you say about my dad? He's probably one of the most well-known sportsmen in this area.
Yeah.
He's a legend, not just as a legend in the fishing game, but a legend to friends, family. He's taught so many people how to fish, how to tie knots.
Yeah.
He's taught all of us how to live life. He is a legend in all aspects.
Well, I think that's a very nice introduction for your dad, Ray. And I think we're going to call him on right now, and you can swap seats with him. Thank you for that. We expect you to give chirps every now and again as well, because we need to. You know, we kind of need a truth serum every now and again with some of our guests. So we're going to welcome on George. George, welcome to the show. It's fantastic to have you on.
Thanks very much for having me.
It's magic, man. And I tell you what, I have been flooded with messages as well, and I hear you have as well. Once we decided to put you on the show, everybody's saying that this man's got a lot of stories and he knows he's fishing.
I think I'm known better in Cape Town
than
any other city in South Africa. Although I've fished the coast from Southwest Africa right up to Mauritius, Seychelles, Madagascar only once. Good fishing there, but they're not clued up like the other islands that are high up.
Okay.
But I've fished many places all over the world. North America, South America, Honolulu, south of India, the Mediterranean, south of France. So I've fished in many places. I wish I had all the money I spent there.
But you know, what's the use of having the money if you haven't lived that life story? You know, you need to live your life properly. You know, that's the whole thing.
Can I tell you something? I can never take it out of my head. I've been all over the world. I've met beautiful people.
Yeah.
And the fishing people are the greatest people in the world.
Yeah.
Because everybody, if you catch a big fish, they're the first to congratulate you. Not like some sportmen, they get beat in a race, they don't even want to talk to the guy.
You know.
But with fishing, if you get a good fish, everybody's there to congratulate you.
Is it? And I see a fires, because I know fires, Mike from Fury has been the one that's been organizing with you guys, because he knew you. And he's a cricketer, you know, he can be quite a bad sport at times, I think, Fires, you know, when he gets, if he's trying to bowl at Oak and he's not getting him out there, you know, it'd be a problem.
I watched Fires many times.
I'm just teasing.
Can I just say, Ron McCurdy, if you're watching this,
yes.
I'm sorry I couldn't say goodbye to you. You left here in South Africa a couple of days after being here for many years. I hope you're watching this today.
I'm sure you can. You might not be awake now, but you surely will watch it at some stage, because I think they're a couple of hours ahead. We were watching the Grand Prix yesterday, and it was all out of kilter the whole all the time. Eh? Rory Norton. Let's have a look at some comments here before we start here, George. Rory Norton, do you know that chap? George may recall a deep sea boat, sea urchin, belonged to my late dad, Trevor Norton.
Oh, very well. I remember that boat, sea urchin.
Eh?
I can't remember Roy, but I remember the boat, sea urchin.
Well, I'm sure Rory was probably small then.
Yeah.
Sea urchin. So was Trevor also a fisherman then, obviously, back then?
Yeah.
Okay. One of the, was also a PE side, or was that PE side?
No, sea urchin was a PE boat.
A PE boat, yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. And then I said, Tunastic Fishing Charter says, hello from Tunatic, like a fanatic. And Sean Sullivan says, Smiley Ray. That's one of Ray's mates, no doubt. There we go. Dwayne Doldoff.
Yes.
That's Helen's, yes.
Ex-Sleepy, yeah. Ex-Sleepy
as well. I know Helen and Mike. It was Barwood, Mike Barwood, and Helen's now a Doldorf. I think she's married. I don't know if Helen's related, must be. Dwayne says, how's it, Ray? And then and David, of course, hey, but you grew your hair for this.
I've been shaving the hair for 20 years, so
really?
First time most people see me with hair.
Well, I'm glad we did it on Gino Spot. There we go.
How's it, David?
Sean Sullivan says, hello, Uncle George. John Skippers says, how's it, Gino? You know, John is the original car park John. The BS?
Yes, yes.
He sits at the car park there and surfs a lot. is a surfer. And then I see, said, why do you, Kathy Pretorius staying, saying, how's it, guys? Jean-Claude Smith as well says, hello, my grandpa. Is that Jean-Claude? Is that your grandpa?
How's it, my boy? Love you.
Oh, man. And so, I mean, George, at the moment, you're obviously retired. You've turned 85, 85th birthday?
Yeah.
And
February.
Is it?
Yeah.
And so at the moment, are you just relaxing, just retiring?
No, I'm going to go another 20 years.
Still going.
Yeah.
You got 105.
I'm so fit and healthy.
Well, last year, my dad fished the day in the Tuna Classic.
Really?
Yep.
Took all day.
Hmm?
Yes, sir, George. No, it's draining, that stuff.
God has blessed me with good health all my life.
Hmm.
So I don't know. My father lived to 96.
Wow.
My mother to 92, so I'm one of the good old school.
There we go. And they say every generation you live longer.
And when I was 3 years old, on the last day of every month, we all had to have castor oil.
Castor oil?
You youngsters today, you can be glad you don't get castor oil. It's horrible. But it gets you to go old.
Any of the guys out there used to drink castor oil? Because there were cod liver oil as well, was the other one.
Yeah, well.
It's like, take a teaspoon a day. What the hell were they thinking?
Castor oil was horrible.
Yes,
anyway, my mother gave it to me, and I hope to grow past my mother's age.
All right, excellent. I'll just see, Gary's a couple more comments there. Let's just quickly directly shoot through some of them. I see the other grandpa, I hope you well. I miss you lots, is Jean-Claude Smith. And Tais Kun says, hello from Lebos.
Yeah, Lebos.
Lebos. Where is Lebos?
How's it, Tais?
No, Lebos is his boat.
Oh, is his boss? Okay. Yeah. Now, what boat have you got?
Head.
I had Sea Princess.
Sea Princess.
And with Tais's boat at Cape St. Francis, we won a Tuna Classic.
Wow.
I got a fish of 85 kilos. Won us a lot of money. And we all had a good time in that competition.
Yo, nice.
And Tais is a good friend of mine. He spent a couple of days with me, a couple of hours with me about a week and a half ago.
Lovely.
And he's a good guy, and he's really an absolute gentleman. Well done, Tais.
Excellent. I see George, John Allen there saying, how's it as well? George from Big John.
Yeah.
Is that another John?
Another excellent and absolute gentleman. In the fishing game, you don't have guys that hate you when you do well. You all congratulate somebody who gets a good fish.
Well, that's the old school way of doing it then, obviously.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Ray's generation are different. They moot each other when they,
they make each other drown.
There we go. Let's have a look. Mel is here as well. I see Mel. That's your, is that your wife?
Yep.
Mel, has it? And they're saying, hi, Dad. And
other than my darling.
There we go. It's your daughter-in-law is always your favorite, don't
you?
Yeah. You know. Francois Ott says, how's it, Ray and Oum, George? Watching, heard all the fishing stories.
Francois, haven't heard from you for years.
Yeah, that's my work with me.
Yeah, okay. And then Camilla says there, my mother tried to kill me with ball stall every time we had a cold.
Ball stall. That is medicine.
You remind me of my father. There we go. And Mark Crail saying, how's it as well? XVP as well. There we go. David and Mark, we were together as well. Dad looks good on his age 85, says Claudel. Huh?
Yeah.
Absolutely. And Nicole Nielsen as well. Also, Uncle Georgie looking good from H and Nikki in Scotland.
Yeah.
Are they watching from there?
Yeah, I've got a friend in Norway is also watching now.
Oh, is it? Norway.
Mike Johnson. He's in Norway.
Okay, gee whiz. So Nicole Nielsen also, but Nielsen sounds like it should come from Norway as well, or from Sweden.
Yeah, Nielsen is a Norwegian name.
Yes, so Sweden is at least.
Norway and Sweden.
Yeah, similar vibes, eh?
Yeah.
Similar vibes. And have you ever fished up there?
Never.
Cold?
It's too cold. I like warm water fishing.
Oh, is it?
Blue water is big fish.
Oh, is it?
All my life I've caught big fish. I've been lucky. Okay. God has given me good luck in my life.
And the cold waters, is it different with fishing? I mean...
Oh, if you're not a fisherman, you won't fish in go. If you're a fisherman, you will not fish in go waters. Really? Fish don't feed in go water. Fish feed in deep blue seas. The warmer the water, the more hungry the fish become.
Really? So the more that they are. Oh, that's classic, man. And I mean, I know, look, clearly fishing is going to be the main theme of this show. But I mean, let's go back in the history, George, to where you were born. Where were you? Where did you come from originally?
I was born in Cape Town. I'm a twin. Okay. My late sister Mary's passed away.
Okay.
It was myself and three girls. My sister Kathy passed away about 15 years ago, my sister Dorothy 5 years ago, and Mary 3 years ago. So I've lost all my family. I'm the only relative.
You lost.
The last of the greatest.
The last Rodocanachi.
And by the way, Jenny, I love you. I know you're watching.
Oh, sure.
Yes. Jenny's been with me for 15 years.
Oh, okay.
She's filled my life with a lot of joy.
Oh, lovely, man, lovely. And so born in Cape Town.
Yep.
And
moved to Cookhouse.
Moved to Cookhouse after that. Tell me about Cookhouse. How did you get to Cookhouse?
Well, there's a lot of cooking Cookhouse. I mean, they cook all kinds of things there, you know that? I hope you can scratch it off.
No, we'll just mute it.
Well, Michael said I can say that.
No, it's fine.
So I blame you, man.
Yeah. So, I mean, you were brought up. Was your dad farming there or what?
No, my father worked on the railway. He was a signal connector.
Oh, wow.
We had the station master's house, a beautiful home in Cape Town.
Wow.
I'll never forget one day. We came from school and I saw a broken down pram. I wanted to go pick it up, fell over. I still got the scar today on my leg, yeah. And my late sister Dorothy, my second eldest sister, carried me all the way home.
You fell down when you were younger?
I cut myself. I'd have 18 stitches in my leg.
That's quite a
thing. And that's something that lives with me.
Okay. Yours.
She carried me all the way home.
Oh, shaman. Yeah.
When she came home, she was full of blood.
Oh, man.
And really, it lives with me.
Yeah, no, of course.
Let's talk more about the fishing.
Yes,
Your first fishing Cookhouse.
Yeah.
When I was 6 years old, my father took me down to the river for 5-6 times. Old reed rod.
Really?
No nylon those days. Awesome. String.
Mm. Mm.
Pay a hook on.
Is this the 50s?
That's,
like the 50s.
That's my first season fish I caught. You put a worm on and you got a cork. And if you cork this, you must strike.
Yeah.
And I struck and I was putting it dead.
Yeah.
Dead, I can't get this fish up. And eventually he helped me and he pulled this fish over. And we used to catch mullet that size, that thick.
Yeah.
This fish was that size and that thick.
Yeah.
And 40, 50 years later, I went to Cookhouse and it was still in the billiard room on top of the wall.
But really?
It was golden color from all the smoking in that place.
Yeah.
But there was my fishing guy. They skinned it to be in there. It's probably still there today.
Really?
In the billiard room.
Jeez, but that was in the 40s now.
No, I was born in 37.
Oh, 37, so just early 40s.
That was 52, 55. Yeah. When I left there, Cookhouse, I came to
left there, yeah. Because, I mean, I've got a Seagull motor that was like, I think it's a 1940 something.
So that's
best
about the same
in the world, so many lives, eh?
Yeah, is it? The Seagulls.
Yeah. People went with Seagull motors to get all the people what's that place in the war when they went over to France?
In Zimbabwe, in Victoria Falls?
No. When the war was coming to an end and Hitler was pushing
for... Oh, the D-Day, you mean the
D-Day? What was it? D-Day.
Dunkirk.
Seagull motors. They had enough fuel to come from England 20 miles with a little seagull motor. And they And they're still going today.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mine still goes. It's going
brilliant, brilliant.
It's broken
many,
at the moment.
Many lives, eh?
Yeah.
Many lives.
Well, I'm glad to know that because then I'm going on with that.
Maybe old people like me that will save. I'm probably watching this.
Yeah.
Good luck to you if you're still alive.
Absolutely. And you know, so from cookhouse with the equipment must have been like you said, it was just basic. And then you came from cookhouse to PE. Is that right?
To PE and
okay.
When I was 8 years old, somebody invited me to come and fish on the station wall.
Yes, sir.
And he was an older gentleman and I caught my first fish there.
Yeah.
And it was a lairfish about that size, which is not very big, probably about 3 kilos.
Yeah.
But those days they never put any fish back like today. We put a lot of fish back today.
Yes.
And then I got interested. By the time I was 14, 15, I needed a bicycle. I used to go down there and catch what we call babies, which is in the town they call them quarantine.
Yeah, a quarantine.
And I used to sell them for a tickey at time, and that's how I bought my first bike for £2.
Dead. Bicycle.
80 tickies to the pound.
Can you remember what kind of bicycle it was?
I think it was a Phillips. I'm not
is
sure.
It a Phillips?
But hey, okay. I'm getting older.
Trevor's asking if you remember pots and pans.
Very well.
What is pots and pans? Explain this to me.
With that photograph with me standing with that first shark, he still said to me, George, put his head on today. It was a big comment.
Yeah.
And the kite took it out by the point of the breakwater. He said, today you'll catch your first shark. And I caught my through pots and pans. Pots and pans died 5 hours from me. Not more than about 8 or 10 years ago.
Oh, okay.
He was a legend.
Really?
He used to make fishing reels out of aluminium pots.
Yo. Is that what he called it?
That's why they call him Pots and Pans. He used to buy pots and pans.
What was his name, actually? Somebody will know.
His surname is LaRue.
They'll tell us. Yeah.
But if his son is watching, you'll probably say, Dad.
There you go, Mr. LaRue. She said, Barbara Manners asking, did you fish with him?
Okay.
Yes, pots and pans, absolutely. Yes. Yeah. You ever fish with him? with pots and pans.
And then the late Alfred Table used to fish, and they all helped me. I was a youngster of 18, you had to be 16 to get a license to go to the breakwater.
Okay.
But I was a watchmaker and I had enough money to buy my reel. I took a year to save up to buy myself a reel.
Jeez.
And when I bought, everybody was, those days, there was no animosity in the world.
Yeah.
And that's where I learned to fish.
Yeah.
On the breakwater in B.
So you have to be a gentleman to fish.
But I wouldn't go
all,
that far.
All fishermen are gentlemen. All my life, I taught people and I see them doing the wrong thing. I say, do this, do that.
Yeah.
And I've had so many comments. George, you taught me to fish.
Yeah.
And it's not like any other sport. Boxing, they hate each other. Running.
Well, they hurt each other.
Surfing. They actually get annoyed when you do well.
Yes.
Fishing, everybody's happy when you catch a big fish. Yeah. Really.
No, very like I mean, with the history of within, especially with you, I mean it must be close to your heart. So I mean those early fish that you caught, those must be good memories.
Very much so.
Yeah.
I remember my first poonscob I caught. I didn't even know what kind of fish it was, and I said, poonscob, what a funny name.
Your poonscob.
Which is a black muscle cracker for those guys in Durban are watching.
Okay.
We call it poonscob,
is that one there?
That's a red steam
rice. Okay. I don't know where the poonscob was. Well,
it's a black fish.
It's a black fish.
Okay.
I caught one of 86 pounds. It was an SA record.
Yeah.
Somehow I happened, I never claimed the record. Mm. There were a lot of records I never claimed.
Because if you catch them, you got to actually claim the record. There we go, that looks like. Is that
that's him, that's him. It weighed 86 pound, that fish.
And what, the mussel cracker, is it called because it eats mussels? Or
they've got very big molded round teeth.
I see those.
And they just crash. Perlimoon, they even crash perlimoon.
Really?
They just bite and they crack the skin and they eat it.
Yeah, they're so strong.
And, but that fish weighed 86 pounds.
Yeah.
Then the record was 84, and I claimed it, but I never got the record. Somehow the information went missing.
Oh, okay.
But that happened many times in those days. Well, maybe the oak, 40 years ago.
The oak that was 84 kilograms, he somehow didn't subscribe to the same
pound in those days.
Pounds.
86 pounds, which is about 38 to 40 pounds.
Yeah, so that other oak with two less pounds, he was less gentlemanly than you thought he was. So he
I don't think so.
He lost your papers.
Probably worked at the post office.
Yeah, he probably did. Did you have to post office stuff? You have to post off your... How does it work? So you get this fish, that's like a huge fish, and then you want to check if it's...
You put it on the internet, you put all the information on, and 2 weeks later you get your world record.
Yeah, but now then?
Those days, it takes 2 years to get a world record. So that's when you start losing interest.
Yeah, of course.
What you had to do is you had to take a photograph of the fish with sunning to show scale and size.
Okay.
And that would be a size scale.
So most of the time we use a cigarette box, as most people know, they knew what cigarette boxes look like. You had to send a sample of the line in.
Okay.
You had to send the certificate of the scale that you weighed it in
and
with.
Witnesses do the
witnesses
sign.
Like PEDSAC or...
Yeah. A sample of your trace line, everything gets posted off there.
The legs on the rod, the type of reel you had, and the breaking strain of the line.
Breaking strain, okay. Because you also got this 20-1 record or whatever it was.
All right. For people who don't know, 20-1, I'm a member of the 20-1 club. If you catch a fish and it weighs 20 pounds, those days pounds, or 20 kilos, and you catch it on a 1 kilo line, the fish is 20 times the weight of the breaking strain of the line.
That is
and I caught a leer fish, which I was actually dead. I went to Cape Town, and the guy says, listen, I don't want to mention the name of the line, but this is a line. I come from America.
Yeah.
Would you like to use this line and see if
special
you can break
line.
A world record?
Wow.
If you catch a world record, and those days, our rand was stronger than the dollar, but you will win $5,000 if you win.
Wow.
So he dared me to catch a fish.
Yeah.
So eventually I bought a little record reel with a very long, thin rod.
Yeah.
And when we used to catch the fish, we had to catch shad in the morning,
yeah.
Put a hook through the head, and the fish will swim behind the boat, and you throw it slowly, and a leer fish would pick it up. And, and after losing 29 fish, I was already starting to lose hope.
Yeah.
And one day...
29 fish you lost.
Yeah. After 9 months and 29 fish I lost, we had an American guy from ICFA on the boat, and I said to him, do you mind if I put out 1 pound line, 1 kilogram line?
Yeah.
What for? I said, I want to catch one of these fish. He'd already caught two fish.
Yeah.
And when you catch these fish, the other fish were behind him, and I put it, we used to have a live bait hatch on the boat.
Okay.
Took him out and then put a little hook in. I used to fire my hooks with sandpaper.
Yeah.
That you get. Because you can't strike that fish.
Okay.
As he pulls away, you can only put 7 ounce play on one pound line. On 1 kilogram line, sorry.
Okay.
But it was 1 pound line. And I had to claim the fish on 1 kilogram because I didn't have a 1 pound license.
Okay.
And I eventually got my $5,000 once I got my diggers.
Yeah.
I wish I bought a brand new rod and reel, which I had for many years. I think I still got it.
Okay.
And I can't mention the name of the reel because it'll be advertising.
Oh, you can advertise. It's fine. You can
all right. It was a Shimano.
Oh, Shimano.
Shimano.
Well, if you still need sponsorship.
And one day Shimano came. We won a competition. My son David, myself, I can't remember the other guy's name. But
Ray. It was Ray.
No, Ray wasn't. Not the fishing came down, and we won these beautiful big Shimano 9-0 reels.
Wow.
And I tell you something, They still going today.
Is it?
It was a beautiful win. Nice,
really.
When I went to America in 68, I could have bought the agency for South Africa.
Yeah.
And
well, you would have had the bicycle stuff now as well, isn't it?
No, I think that's still run secretly.
It's still
run secretly. Anyway, and they said, we went to the seminar, they showed these beautiful rings, doesn't want anybody here want to buy. And I took enough money to America. Those days we weren't allowed more than so much other cutting, but for business I could buy an agency.
Okay.
At about $300,000.
Jeez, like.
Well, I was in the jewelry trade, just big money,
you know.
And I wanted to buy it, but I needed $500,000. So I went to this one guy who was in the team. He was a very rich banana farmer. His name was Retief Rendigas. Okay. I said, Retief, come with me. We're going to make a killing here. I can't say it on the TV, but you can. They're going to go beep for you just now. Anyway, and if I was that, I would have been a multi-millionaire today.
Yeah, of course, of course.
Because that reel, the guys who bought it, there was a firm in Joburg who bought the agency.
Yeah.
They made multi-millions because it was a beautiful reel. Yes. And anybody who's got one today will back me up. It's fantastic
reel. Good reels. And so, because you set that thing now, for the 20 to 1, you've got a £1 line. You have to set that thing, that reel as well.
I'll tell you how we did it. We'll pick the rod up.
Yeah.
And we'll have a... We'll, 7 ounces is just the weight of a little glass bottle.
Really?
You put a piece of line on and you pick it up like that.
Yeah.
And you turn, you drag off, and it will start sliding down.
Yeah.
And that's 7 ounces breaking. So, and you don't touch your drag after that.
Okay.
So if you fish with a 7 ounce breaking strain, the fish can run, he'll just run.
Yeah.
But when you wind him and comes in and you wind in and it's not winding in, it's more than 7 ounces. That's why your line doesn't break.
Okay.
And that's the way you do. The guys who really fish light tackle will know exactly what I'm talking about. People who don't know, maybe you've learned something now.
Yeah, for sure. So you just wind it in until he starts going out and then let it slide.
Yeah, if you pass the 7 ounces, the line just runs. You don't wind.
Yes.
The moment he slows out, then you can wind in the line again. And if it goes over 7 ounces, it takes a line out. And I fought the fish for 4 hours and 5 minutes. Eventually, it was so tired, it was drifting a little more. We reversed up against the fish, we capped the fish.
Sure.
You know what I did?
Yeah.
I took my rod, I said goodbye, plug it off, I threw it in the water. You done your work.
Really?
Never use that rod and reel again.
Sure.
Because I've achieved something.
Yeah.
But only because it was a dare, I said, come on, show us, George, you can do it, and I did it for a dare.
Yeah.
And now I'm a member of the 21.
Excellent.
But they have up to 25 to 1 clubs that catch 1,000-pound marlin on 40-pound line.
Yeah. The marlin.
Yeah.
Also, have you caught marlin as well?
Yeah, I've caught salmon marlin in my time.
Jeez. That's like a rodeo.
I caught a better fish. I was the first man in South Africa to catch a broadbill.
Yeah.
I got my springbuck colors to go to America in 1978 to catch broadbill. We went to Fort Lauderdale and we caught broadbill there. That's when they first started catching them in 1968.
It's like a swordfish
It's actually called a swordfish.
Okay.
Because it hasn't got a round bill like it's got a flat bill.
Okay.
So what it does, it cuts the...
It slashes the
squid in half, and then it gobbles it up.
It literally cuts it. It must be sharp.
And I went down there. Within 2 hours, we used to go down one line 50 meters, another line 100 meters, and then third line 150. I was at 100 meter line. And I felt something bump, I hooked a fish, and I was into a fish. And after an hour, I got the fish next to the boat, and it was about 350 pounds, I estimated.
Wow, that's big.
But that fish's flesh is so soft.
Yeah.
It's like if you foul hook it,
yeah.
Because they come and they grab it so fast, so 90% in the time they're not hooked in the mouth.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was hooked in the side, and it was pulling the side. And when it came within 5 meters of the boat, a hook pulled.
Okay.
And I tell you, I was broken.
Disappeared.
I got 12,000 miles to lose a fish next to the boat. So I went down, and my turn to go 50 meters, I went down, and within 3 seconds I went down, I was into another one, but I caught that one. But the fish only weighed 29 pounds. Okay. Sorry, 70 pounds. About 29 kilos. It made my day. I was broken hearted because I came here to catch a broadbill and I caught the only one in the team.
We got two. One got away.
Yeah. But the biggest fish in that competition was 660 pounds. I've got photographs in an album which I should have given to you.
We got some pictures here. Let's have a look at some of the fish you caught here. There we go. That's what the hell is that?
No, that fish I never caught. That fish, that fish I caught. I caught him on the crayfish banks. But he had already lined out, he lost his colours. But when we threw water at him, all the colours of the rainbow would come out of him. To this day, they call it a moonfish.
Yes, a moonfish.
But that was a common name. That's what the colours called it.
Yeah.
I still don't know what that fish is today. Okay. I never claimed any record, but that fish weighed about 65, 70 pounds those days.
Okay.
And I got grey at 21, you see, I was grey.
Yes, I see that.
And my hair was longer than it is today. But that's one of the nicest fish I could say that I caught.
What did you catch that on?
We used to use pulses to go down to 110 meters of water to catch carpenter, and I hooked and I caught that fish.
That's a shark. What is that?
That's
my Mako. That's an SA record Mako fish. It was 370 pounds when I caught that. It was those days was all pounds before the kilos came in.
Yo.
I can't remember. I think it was before 1960.
And where did you catch that?
In the mouth.
In the mouth.
I caught it at Cape St. Francis. We used to fish for sharks at Cape St. Francis. One day the late Professor Smith and his wife Margaret came there. They said, we want to see all these fish. We used to call, we know what a great white and a backer was, but all these other grey fish, we didn't know what they were.
Yeah.
Then we found out, one's a ridgeback grey, one's a... there's so many, there's about five different species of greys.
Oh, wow.
And we caught 22 that day. We had a record catching that day. And Professor Smith, don't kill him. Don't put him back. He measured him and he emptied his stomach. And he sent me a report on it, about 15 or 20 pages from that day that he's been there.
Wow, I studied them.
And the late Margaret Smith kept in touch with me for many years with the sharks we used to catch.
Okay. Smith, is that...
If you catch a shark and you get the same speed, cut it up and we want to know what they're eating.
Yes.
What was the temperature of the water? What was the winds that day? What time of year it was?
Yeah.
And I caught thousands of sharks at my time.
She would say, there's another one there. So
that's what we used to call spear eyes. But there were five different spear eyes we caught.
Yeah.
That was a gully. We used to pick them up and we used to put them on a block and tackle and hang them on the scale. You can see it the scale this next to my head there.
Yes.
And we used to pull them up.
Huge bloody sharks.
a red steam rush.
Okay.
I think it was 66 pound, right? I can't remember.
No, it was a little bit bigger.
Anyway, I caught it, not on my own rod, on my own rod and reel. A friend of mine, his name was Noel Serini. He said, I'm going to leave my live bait out here. We're going to go for a cracker.
Okay.
So when we used to fish, we weren't allowed to have more than two rods in the water, but yeah. to have a live bait in the water is always better than to have a dead bait. So I pulled my other rod out, and when he was fishing there, this rod went off and I actually caught a red steelhead. He wasn't happy that I caught it on his rod. I caught it gently, it was caught how can I say, caught fairly. Yeah, I had two rods in the water and I caught that fish. Okay. But he could have caught it at his heart is very sore. Because that's a fish of a lifetime.
But he was congratulatory. Because
a 66-pound that fish weighed. Yo, was 30 kilos.
Yo, that's big. Oh, there's that. That looks like a marlin there, huh? Is that?
No,
is
that, that's for the first broad bull caught in PE.
That was the first broad bull caught in South Africa.
Wow.
With a rod and reel.
Yo. Okay.
What is it weigh? I can't remember.
Your fish weighed 20 kilos. I think
21 kilos it weighed.
Gerd caught the other one. I can't remember what it weighed.
Gerd caught one and Eric, the late Eric de Villiers caught one.
And I see someone there with a camera. Is that Fires?
No, that was actually SABC at the time.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay. Because I mean, you've got a lot of records. Like, there's 11 world records. Is that right?
Yeah. And 55 South African
55
records.
55 South African records. I mean, that is like, that's a lifetime's work, that.
It is.
Yeah.
Up until about 5 years ago, I was third highest record holder in the world for world records.
Wow.
Because they're not easy to catch. You've got to go out and look for it. Once you catch your first world record, then you want to go further and further and do more achievements.
Yeah.
It's like when a runner breaks a 100-meter record, he wants to make it shorter and smaller, like the 4-mile record. Yes. Bannister was the first one to break a world record under 4 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah.
3 minutes 58, if I remember.
Yeah.
Because everybody wants to achieve something, and that's what I wanted to do.
There we go. David's just saying, Mike Feisman being buckling down on his knees when we were catching yellowtail at the Burl Island. What happened there?
That's actually a very funny story.
It's a funny story. Mike and his wife came up to the bay that day before he went down. These guys catch a mussel today. I will show him how to catch mussel crack. Yellowtail. Yellowtail is one of the strongest fish in the sea. So Mike says, because I'm fit and strong. Anyway, by the way, I hold the South African record for the biggest yellowtail on 15 kg, but it should have been on 10 kg, but my double line was 2 inches too long, so I had to claim it on 15 kg. But it was actually caught on 10 kg in a competition, South African competition where it be. Anyway, so Mike says, I'll show you how to pull him. So Mike gets a big yellowtail on about 25 kilos. Uh-huh. And he pulls it. Eventually Mike was on his knees. But I can't lift the fish. Then we heard afterwards, Dot said to us, you know, Dot, I hope you're listening now, and Fires you as well. He told me, we are not strong like him. To catch fish, but it's not how strong you are.
Yeah.
When he rests, you pull.
Yeah.
When he pulls, you rest.
Yeah,
that's the secret of fishing.
Okay, is that the way to do it?
Yeah.
When he's because I mean,
but he was pulling all the time when the fish is running.
Just
when the fish stopped running, he was so tired he couldn't really push them. But eventually, he landed the fish.
Just to elaborate, it's a 3 fish in a row.
Okay,
first he went down. He hooked a big fish.
Yeah.
We were fishing in about 50 meters of water.
Yeah.
A place called, or about 45 meters of water, sorry. A place called 6 Mile Reef.
Okay.
Off Bird Island.
He went down, he hooked a big fish, just over 10 odd, pulled it up, gave him a good workout, put another bait, went down, barely hit bottom, another big fish, also in the teens. Struggled, pulled it up, got up this time. Now he's taking his time to put the bait on. You know, I don't want to get a fish again.
Yeah.
Went down, belly down, and then hit another big one.
Another one.
And by the time he got that one to the top, he was on his knees trying to pull it up.
He was nearly on the boat. Raising the rod down. If you raise the rod down in any competition, the fish gets disqualified. You've got to hold it in your hand. Raise it on the gun, it's disqualified.
Yeah, really? So it's not some rules like that? No, you can't let it rest in the boat, is that right?
No, if you're catching, especially if you're catching live tackle, if you rest a lot on the gunwale to have a rest, the skip of the boat can come and cut your line next to
the reel. Oh, no ways, have they done that?
No.
It's happened before.
When you fish live tackle competition, it's very strict.
Yours?
Very.
Okay, good.
So if you catch a fish and light tackle, you've got to play the game like it should be played.
There you go. Claudette says, my dad won't stop talking about his life of fishing because he's famous for fishing.
It's Claudel.
That's a Claudel. So yeah. He's saying Claudette. Yeah,
love you too, Mike.
Claudel. Yeah, love you too, Ray, he says. And I see wonderful to hear, remember all the weights of the fish. And you have got a good memory like that. Jesus, man. And the places where you caught them, I suppose.
But all my fish I normally catch in the mouth.
Yeah. I think you're talking about swat corps or something. But it's not, you're talking about the mouth. You're lying. You just don't want to give me places.
Most of my fish have been caught from rock and surf.
Okay.
Rock and surf. And then I went to sea. I got hooked once I went to the sea because there's so many more fish at sea.
Yeah.
Now, once we fished in a competition many, many, many years ago, I think I was about 25 or 30, we went to a place on the city harbour called Vittelsbos, and I caught a redfish this size. Yeah. It was a 74, it weighed 19 pounds. It was an SA record.
Wow.
74 for the rock and surf.
That is not in the 60s then. I think if you're 20 in your 20s, then it must have been in all the 60s.
I can't remember. I can't even remember when I caught it, but I still got the photograph somewhere.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was the most beautiful fish to eat.
Really?
Really. And that's what, that was my first South African record I ever caught.
Yeah.
The guy says, that's the biggest 74. Don't cut on it. Don't do anything. Don't cut it. Because the fish has got to be whole. I never knew those days.
Yeah, yeah.
And we won the competition in the Cotton Trophy. We used to fish at any venue in the Eastern Cape from all the rock and surf teams. And it was a very nice competition. Anyway, we won that competition.
So rock and surf, I mean, obviously, you started on the harbour wall. I was just looking at a picture the other day. It was posted on Facebook of the house that they used for the Sea Scouts there at King's Beach.
Mm-hmm.
And that house used to be on the rocks on the water.
Yeah.
Mm. And when they built the harbour wall out there, then obviously that sand all came in us about a kilometre away from the beach. It's amazing. Yeah. But so in those days was the shoreline different, very, very different?
No, it was very similar to that. When I was younger, I used to fish in the breakwater.
Yeah, yeah.
But I used to go with my father, was not allowed to put the fish in the water, and I should see all these big fish in there.
Yeah.
I said, please come 16. I was 14. I couldn't wait to put a line. One day my father wasn't looking, so I put a line and I caught a hot dog. I said, do you want me to go to jail? He said. Because they were very strict on youngsters.
Really?
Instead of encouraging it, today I would encourage them to teach, to show people. Oh, by the way, that's a photograph of mine. All fishing stories started with a tail. That was at Macca. You saw this now?
Yes, yes.
That was a tail. For my album, all fishing stories start with a tail.
Okay, all right, I see. Yes.
Now that's the ending of my album.
That is a big bloody fish.
And that's my first shark ever. Bots and Band still gave me the head to put on the catch. That's a red light on the end of the breakwater.
Okay. Right,
before they built it more bricked up?
Yes, yes.
It was mainly metal.
Before they built all the dollars outside of the breakwater to stop the water eating the solid wall.
Yes.
Which worked very well. A guy in East London actually designed it.
Do you know the dollar story? Because I've heard lots of things about that.
It was designed.
Oh, he didn't make any money and this.
He never made money.
Yeah.
And it's today, if he solely designed, he would have been a billionaire today. But he was the harbour master in his London. Oh. I can't remember his name, but he called it the Dollars.
Okay. And what does the Dollars mean? Huh?
I don't know. It's a black name for something funny, I think.
Okay.
Anyway, in his famous lyrics, now I wish your father or your grandfather made money out of it, because you know how well it works.
Yeah.
It's worked throughout the world.
Brilliant.
Because when you throw them down, they hook into one another. And when a big wave hits it, it breaks away in smaller pieces.
Yes, it does. Eh?
Yeah.
David's saying that Dad landed an 84 kilogram marlin on an 8 kilogram line. Marlin jumped straight into the boat.
Now, when we had the fish next to the boat, I had a Rapala on and the marlin took me. I actually saw him took me. I said, it's a marlin.
Rapala is a type of lure.
It's a
type of lure. I should have brought one to show you. Whatever. Anyway, he came up and I saw him. Actually, I said, I just hooked the marlin, and he screamed off. I said, slow down.
Because
a marlin takes 200-400 kilos before he starts. And he jumps out the water, and he jumps out the water. And I only had 8 kg line on. And because I loved catching fish on line tackle, it was a challenge to me. And we eventually landed the fish, but when he came down, there was a macker wanted to eat him next to the boat. And the macker came from me, turned around, and he jumped between the motors and my fish hatch.
Yes, look.
Everybody ran into the cabin except me. I jumped on the top of him. I was holding his butt and he was hurting because the bullet is rough. It took all the skin off my hand. I said, come and help me. And all. But
where were you, David?
That marlin jumped into the boat. David will remember. Were you on the boat, right?
No, I wasn't on the boat.
But I'm sure David was on the boat.
David will remember that. I'm sure he's probably scarred him for life.
He's probably going to come and say, Dad, I wasn't on the boat now. Or was.
Yes, look. What's that? Fires.
What did you say now?
Yeah, David says, Fires used to bunk cricket practice when we used to catch cob at night at St. Croix.
Yeah.
Some good nights after Dan, just some serious coaching. Always the teacher.
Yeah.
Always teaching.
Yeah.
I mean, you do knots and all sorts. Eh? I mean, you know this stuff.
I was a champion knot tying. I went to America and won a prize in America for my different knots. But Ron McCurdy,
Has
gone back to RG now.
Yeah.
He fished many times. He shall have to fish with me.
Yeah.
And Rod was big and strong, you know.
Yeah.
And another bike from Viren, I can do this, I got it. But then he found out, it's not how strong you are, how clever you are. Because when the fish rest, you pull. When he pulls, you rest. That's the secret about when you fish. For a big fish on light line, especially on light line.
Yeah.
But Ron, if you're watching this, I love you, my friend.
I'm sure you'll be
able to watch. We had a lot of good times together, a lot of prizes in my house in Miramar.
Well, you know, if he's watching from Australia, Rod, I've got you in my sights for getting you on the show as well. We'll have to have him on the show too, because I'm sure he's got a lot of friends here.
It's early morning there.
We'll have to do it at a better time. That's a hell of a big hammerhead, that. Holy where was that?
494 banner. I actually saw this fish on the water. We were fishing at Cape St. Francis at a 600 centimeter. I said, whoa, I didn't know what it was. Yeah. Until he lifted his head out of the water, I quickly pulled out my rod, put a half a mullet on, and in front of where we actually built a platform on that rock so we could
stand on the rocks.
We built a platform.
Well, he caught that off the rocks.
And a little house where we used to go overnight and sleep at night.
I sleep as
and well. And quickly, there was like a pool put out there with this low tide. You could get it. Cast and bait out it. As he hit the water, this fish came up. That fish, and he took my bait. And he didn't take very long, about 2.5 hours, I landed him up, and I'm not having a long trace like when we used to fish for the bigger sharks.
Yeah.
We had to put him up the gun, and one guy actually jumped in the water and grabbed him up the air, and he pulled him up the gully. And
gets in with a shark.
That is still the biggest hammerhead ever caught and rod and reel in South Africa. Wow. And it's a common species, not a bronze. There's two species, the bronze and that's the black common species, which is in the southern hemisphere, they get those ones in warmer water.
Well, I have seen a whole lot of hammerheads at St. Francis, even on the
small ones. Yeah, the little ones.
Yep. Yeah, the little ones.
They are also the common ones, the black ones.
Yeah.
And when we pulled him out, he was starting to give birth already. He probably came in to give birth. He gave birth to 22 young ones.
Wow.
And when I cut him open, he still had another 5 or 6 inside.
Jeez.
Because I took him to the ocean near him. That fish is a duckbill ray. It's also an SA record. You can see I was young. I wasn't even grey. I still had black hair there, like, right? He'll probably get grey when he gets older like me.
He's already
anyway,
old.
Anyway, that fish I fought, I had 30 pound line or 20 pound line, I can't remember. I fought him for 5 hours and 5 minutes. He took me 21 times from the point of the breakwater to the high blocks in the tank of burger. Eventually, I said, I can't land this. I coaxed him to get to King's Beach and I landed him on King's Beach. And the guy walked in the morning and when he put a gaff in him, he actually dragged him out to sea. That fish is extreme. You see, he's got like a big head on him.
Yeah.
Very, very strong fish.
So what is it called? It's
a duckbill ray.
Duckbill ray, geez.
It weighed 92 pounds, that fish. Yeah.
192.
192 pounds.
The writing's actually on the photograph.
It's still an SA record today, when I last looked.
Hell's bells. And that looks like a
that's marlin. That's my first marlin in PE.
Okay.
I caught an 8 kg. That's a marlin I've caught, an 8 kg. That's my first marlin I ever caught in PE. But he actually committed suicide not to be bitten by a shark. He turned around and he jumped and he landed on the boat.
Yes, that
you
was
see that bull? That bull is not a flat bull like a broad bull. It's got a, but it's very rough. But when I had him, I didn't want to, because when I was finished, my hands, all the skin was on my hand.
Yes,
I held him, I said, come help me. Nobody wanted me. And eventually I took the, we called it the kitty, like a big bat, and I hit him on the head so he could lie still, so he wouldn't jump off the boat.
But a local like anesthetic.
Yeah, I see that. Yeah. Jeez, like, so, I mean, we were talking about it.
That fish there is a tuna. I caught in the Fangatani at Jeffrey's Bay.
St. Francis.
That
was the fish off Le Boss.
Yeah. Okay. I caught that fish off Le Boss. It weighed 86 kilos. 85 kilos.
Yeah.
85.2 kilos. It won us the niggas. That's David there. Who's that behind me?
Me.
That's David and Ray. Oh. That's two boys there.
Oh, well,
it's nice for your own dad.
You know it.
I've got it. Hey, my eyes
are there. I know they're too. You know, it's just my
opposite operation. At
oh, of course. Okay.
Anyway, he was taller than me, so it can only be Ray.
That's a newspaper articles.
That was also a tuna.
No, that's your yellowtail, your 19.
Oh, my 19.5 kilo yellowtail when the line was too long. So I claimed it on 15 kg instead of 10 kg.
Gee, so it would have even been better.
If we won that tournament as well.
Wow, okay. There we go. Who's that with that?
That's a bramble shark.
Oh, right, yes.
Very rare. Prehistoric laser.
That fish, only 6 were ever caught in South Africa.
Wow.
First on rod and reel.
Okay. Wow.
That's the biggest one that was ever caught.
It's flat at the bottom.
Yeah.
And they say it crawls on the bottom
like an
alligator.
Kind of
so that's why it's also called an alligator shark.
Okay.
The skin is very, very soft. You can actually see it was wrapped.
Yeah.
And you can see the line marks and the marks on the fish.
Yeah.
Because you just touch it and the skin used to peel off. Because it's normally an extreme
deep water
fish.
Soft
and it was caught in 27 meters of water.
Yeah.
It was a lost fish, if ever.
He
was out of his area.
Gee, was. There's a nice...
That's a 14.5 kilo layfish they caught on, I think it was 8 kg.
No, yeah, 8 kg. You were fishing 6 back then.
Huh?
You were fishing 6 back then.
Six kg.
Okay, maybe 6 kg.
Wow.
I had 5 SA records on Leofish. I don't know how many got today. I haven't checked them for 20 years.
Gee,
I don't fish for records anymore. I fish for the love of fishing.
Yes, of course. Let's just have a couple. Look at a couple of these comments as well while we're there too. I see there's another. Is that one of your? Is that Ray? Is that you?
Yeah, me up there.
Doing something there.
Please tell
us about Sea Princess and how you used to land up. How did you land up with her? How did you land up with Sea Princess?
My dad built it from scratch.
You built?
Hmm? Yeah.
Built your own boat?
Yeah.
Like
Willie Ross actually built the first hull for a friend of mine who I think is also passed away. He had the first boat.
Yeah, I can't remember, but anyway, it was a 24 foot, which they extended to 26 foot.
Wow, okay.
And, well...
It was hardly.
Effectively, I mean, I was a lightie. I was like 8, 9 years old.
Yeah.
And every Sunday, I used to go with my dad, because they built the boat. How long did it take you to build that boat?
Wasn't 8 months.
So, jeez, close to a year.
Okay. We used to do it only on a Sunday.
Okay.
But it was a fantastic boat. It's now in the Seychelles and it's still working. Not Seychelles, in Zanzibar.
Oh, Zanzibar.
And it's still being fished in Zanzibar.
Gee, was it? And that was Sea Princess?
Yeah.
Okay.
A friend of mine bought it. He came from Zanzibar. He said, I want to buy your boat. But I can only pay you 10,000 a month. Yeah. How much you want for it? I said, 70,000 rands.
Yeah.
Well, I'll give you 10,000. When I finish paying, I'll take it. But he was, when he paid half, I knew he wasn't going to cheat me. Yeah. When he paid half, I said, well, you can take it. Okay. And he took it from here to LM, put it in the water there. They put an extreme amount of fuel on it.
Yeah, yeah.
And they ran it all the way. And when they ran out of fuel, they were going to a cove and the Black Sea all along the coast would run it and buy fuel for them. 30,000 rands worth of fuel from LM to Zanzibar.
Holy moly.
But they got the boat there and it's still working today.
So they just go until they run out of fuel and they're like,
we're getting lower, let's pull to the side.
Yes, four strokes. What was it, four strokes? They were Suzuki's.
Suzuki's.
2-4 stroke 150 Suzuki's.
Wow, so two of them. And all the way to flipping Zanzibar. Dot von Furen says the old woman with white hair is doing a great job.
Let me tell you that story.
Okay, yes.
So this guy comes to the club and he says, guys, I've just seen the most amazing thing now.
Yeah.
Sea Princess could handle a big sea.
Yeah, yeah.
And the one way you could get over a big sea is to go very fast, so you rode on top of the chop.
Yes, yes.
Instead of going through the waves.
Okay, yes, yes.
So on this particular day, this boat was riding slowly, going through the waves.
Yeah.
We were on top of the ocean, going over 25, 30 knots on top, running along the coast.
Okay.
Because a big westerly
is
blowing.
In front of Amsterdam.
So yes, yes. This guy says, I've just seen the most amazing thing. He says, yeah, it's a big sea, we're barely riding. Next thing, this boat come flying past us, bad out of hell. He says, but you know what the most amazing thing is? A skipper by an old lady with white hair.
Well, I went white when I was 21, I had white side hair. By the time I was 25, it looked the same as
this. Gee, was that? So always, you've always been grey like that.
Yeah.
And Manuel Alting was the same at VP as well, I remember. Yeah. He'd been grey early. Yeah. Yeah, jeez. Okay, so let's have it. David's saying that Pancho Vivias has been a great part of the family. Dad Pancho and I were at sea, big ship bearing down on us. We had to move and we lost a yellowfin tuna. We estimated 100 kilos right next to the boat. Pancho and I were more upset than Dad.
You see that fish is so big, you can't just pull him out of the way.
Yeah.
That boat, it was coming down straight on us.
Yeah.
So eventually the line parted.
Yeah.
But that would have been the biggest tuna it'd be ever caught, I can tell you that. That one of 86 is still the biggest one it'd be that I know of.
The elephant, okay. Wow. So that's amazing. So, but I mean, you've got to watch out for stuff. There's stuff, I mean, there's lots of ships in the bay, and especially now.
Page, are you watching?
Yeah, I don't know who's that page. What's your favorite fish to catch?
Me?
Yeah.
My favorite fish is still a learfish.
Learfish?
He's such a clean fighter.
Really?
And, well, I caught many lea fish in my time. Now, everyone that I catch, I put back with grace.
Oh, lovely.
I'm sorry I caught
some. But it was the very first fish you ever caught in PE there. There was the lea fish, you said, off the breakwater.
No. The very first fish I ever caught was a broadmoor fish.
The very first fish when you were young.
When you were young, lea fish, you were talking about.
Yeah, so the love affair continued.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's where it started.
Is it a nostalgic fish for you then?
Yes, of course. I don't catch them to bring anymore. I catch them for the love again.
Yeah.
And of course, when they really catch them right out, they're so tired you can actually ride a boat and let water come through the gills quite fast. Okay. So they revive, and all of a sudden they get out and they swim away. It's a beautiful fish, beautiful looking fish.
Yeah.
But tough to eat. Okay. And if you do it properly, beautiful for pickled fish.
Oh, nice. Really. Well, the Easter's coming, eh?
But they call it a leer fish because they say it's a leer fish. The skin is like leather.
Oh, okay.
You've got to skin it, you can't eat the skin because it's too tough.
Jeez.
That's why it's called leer fish.
Yeah, it's okay, I didn't know that.
But in English, it's garrick.
Okay, garrick, okay. And the different fish, I see your favorite eating fish. What would be your favorite eating fish?
Shad and elf.
Shad.
Number one.
Is it,
my dream fish.
Yeah.
I'd rather catch two or three elf, put them on the fire or put them in the pan.
Yeah.
To me, that's the best eating fish in the sea. And I've eaten many types of fish, I tell you, all over the world. It's bigger than any soul I could tell
you. You eat a lot of fish generally.
Oh, I love fish.
You know, we're wondering for long life what you need. I think it just might be that you have to eat a lot of fish. have you eaten mako shark before?
Yeah, I've caught many mako. Okay. What people don't know about the shark, they said, you can't eat a shark because it's got no bladder. Yeah. All sharks and rays have no bladder, so they urinate through their skin.
Okay.
So if you catch a shark, that's the width of the shark like that. Yeah. The top half has got no urine. It's all here by the stomach side.
Oh, really? Okay.
All goes down.
Yeah.
So if you cut the muscle off the top of the shark, of any shark, it's very edible. Okay. And it's got no bones.
Okay, oh, really? Okay.
So and you can get a fillet from a, like a shark, you saw that a piece of fillet that side from the top. But you don't eat the bottom because it's gone.
Okay,
but you can neutralize the bottom off by putting in milk and water.
Okay.
And so you can eat it to neutralize the urine.
Okay, okay.
But you can actually, if you walk on the beach and you see a skate lying, you go up and smell it. It smells like urine.
Oh, really?
And because I have no bladder.
Favorite fishing spot?
Cape St. Francis.
Is it?
Yeah. Wow. I've got a lot of fish in Cape St. Francis at a place called Nutsbuch.
Nutsbuch.
Because the waves come up, and there was one wave is going, pew, and spit all wet and cold in the morning. They call it Nutsbuch.
Okay.
And another place, Jafta's Kraal. It's like a field that they got in. In Sweden, it was almost a mile wide, and it runs in right up it.
Oh, like a fjord.
Yeah, right into the coast. Yeah, we caught beautiful fish. And when I learned to dive,
is that on the wild side there? That's on
more of the wild side.
No, that's it's the Chicago. You go through Bittell's Boys Fire Forestry Station.
Okay,
beautiful place. I used to love it, but you've got to climb down a steep hill, and you climb down. You go down. Going down was beautiful. Coming back was hard. Sometimes you come up there, one or two fish. I wouldn't leave any fish behind. Yeah, I would carry it up there.
Yes.
But it makes you so fit. I used to go there week in and week out, especially in the summer, not in the winter. It gets very cold in the winter.
Yeah.
But very good fishing spot. Got a lot of fish there by time.
And I know a lot of guys are out there at Hewlett's there's a little breakwater, not a breakwater, but some dollars, not some dollars.
At Cape St. Francis.
Yeah.
I put Cape St. Francis on the map.
St. Francis Bay.
I put St. Francis on the map with my shark fishing there.
Yeah, gee whiz.
The late in Ulyss, we said, come to the house, ring the bell, and they come out, they open the gate, and we let us. Because I came there often, and I was starting to catch good fish and getting in the papers, they let me go, used to pay a pound to go through those days. And then when we stopped the car or the 4x4, we still had to walk 3 miles to where we fished. All along the coast, because it was, there's all houses there, you know. Because it's a cape that goes out there. And we used to walk that for the love of fishing.
Incredible.
Then we built all the washing up planks. We made a lovely platform there. We used to go out on a Friday, like on Easter, go out on a Friday afternoon. I used to have a jeweler shop. I let my staff close the shop. I go fishing. Over Easter, come back on Tuesday morning. So we would live on the rocks.
Yes.
At Bunga. We built
bungalows. You would tent or what?
No, we built a house with a roof on like this.
What? Like a shack?
Yeah, shack on the rocks.
Gee whiz, because you go there enough times that you...
And we built a place, a pool, maybe as big as a bath, built across the pool where we used to fish, and we used to get live shab on there. And catch a lot of near fishing the other day in the night, I love that place.
I'm just thinking, what's the process? You're fishing in the rocks now, you've got this bowl that you can put your live bait in, as well. Your bait is the other fish. So you start with a prawn or something, I don't know, what do you...
No,
pilchard.
Catch pilchard, or you catch shad, go to the big one, catch a lot of flathead.
Yeah.
Put it in a bottle, and you put a tin of pulchards with it, and it smells just like pulchards. You know the pulchards in the tin? Limerick pulchards?
Yes.
And you put it in, you catch a couple of shad, then you got your bait.
Okay.
And from the shad, we used to catch sharks on the carb side. On the rough side, you used to catch mussel cracker.
Yeah.
The silver mussel cracker, like they call it, silver steamer, as they call it. Yes. In Durban, in the town, we call it the mussel cracker, because our steamers is a white steamers, which is another species completely different.
Wow. Okay.
But they're now more or less got all the names. Those years, they're different. They used to call it a galleon. On the Transcar, I go to Dambo, we used to call it a galleon. Galleon in Southwest Africa. They used to called shad in Durban, after the those days, but today all the names are all one name.
Yeah, yeah.
No, Dambo there, and Alfia, and shad there, and Cobb there, all got one name.
Okay.
They've now, Professor Smith got that right eventually.
Okay, the Smith Institute. Did you ever fish with Dougie Hislop? With Lazy Gray.
The fastest I ever been to Bird Island was on Doug's boat when he had 200 motors on, 200 yummies on, 55 minutes on Bird Island to PE. Had to come back.
That's quite far out, isn't it?
Bird Island is 32 and a half sea miles, from Portsmouth Harbour.
Okay,
so 55 minutes. So he was doing average of 35 knots. That's what every now and then. Bang! You come down there.
I see somebody's asking if you fished with Colin Johnson.
Dougie's also gone, eh?
Is he?
Yeah, he's gone.
Okay. And David Payton says, did you ever fish with Colin Johnson?
Colin used to fish rock and surf. I knew Colin very well. Rock and surf at Cape Receive. I was never a Cape Receive man, but I knew Colin very well.
When
I fished the Cape St. Francis, Colin used to catch a lot of fish. Won a lot of Angling Week competitions.
Yeah.
And Colin was a very good fisherman. Big, strong guy.
Yeah.
And he could swim out. He would swim out from this rock to that to get to the furthest rock.
Yes.
To catch shad like this and what we call mussel cracker. Today it's got one name, a silver mussel cracker.
Okay.
Which is like a Pinscop, it's got teeth like a cracked muscles.
Yeah, like that as well. What was it? Mike was asking something as well. Dad used to make his own kites, depending how strong the wind was, depending how big or small the kites. So he's kite surfing.
I usually cut fishing. That's how I put it. I usually do kite fishing and cut some branches to take our bait out 200-300 meters out to catch great whites, to catch hammerheads, to catch mainly ragatooth.
How did you get it off? How did you get the line off?
The kite will pull the bait out.
Yeah.
And when it gets to the desired, we had one line for the kite fishing net, a big line coming out of the kite line.
Yeah.
With a flag up there that we can tell how far we are. Yes. And we will drag this big cobhead out or a damba, which is a hullion, which was the best shark bait. Sometimes we used to drag the baits on top of the water, the kite used to be attached to the bait.
Okay.
And when the wind gets too strong, then we get our guys get smaller. The guys and the blacks and the trans guy says, oh, big wind coming, put postage stamp on.
Okay.
More kite like that. But the kite used to be normally about that side, 2 foot by 2 foot for a big kite on light winds. 1 foot by 1 foot.
Specialized cut. I mean, is this
Well, when the wind gets you strong, you put a smaller cut up because your bait must drift down the water. And you could actually see the sharks coming on top of the water. They swim around and come and take the bait. And your kite will go and pull the flag down. When your flag goes down the water, you could strike. And your kite stays attached to your line.
Okay, well, that's
fine. So you pull your line in and the shark. So you had to pull the kite
as well.
The old days, the late Indian man always says, no, that's unfair. The kite lifts the shark out the water. A kite maximum pulled 6 kilos.
Yeah,
6 pounds, sorry.
Yeah.
It was pounds those days.
Yeah.
Maximum 6 pound pull.
Gee, was a kite.
And if it pulls half a pound, the bait used to sink. It means to pull out the kite, pull the bait down, pull a bigger kite down. The bait must be in the water because sharks are surface feeders.
Okay.
If you ever fall off the boat and you see a shark, don't swim like that. You create vibrations.
Yeah.
And the shark eats all vibrations.
Okay. When you go down or what?
No. When a fish dies, fish dies. You
put your thumbs in the eyes.
Now you believe that story. When a fish dies, he comes to the surface and he kicks around like that when he's dying.
Yes.
And a shark will come and he'll get that vibration, he'll come up and he'll eat.
So what is this?
We used to inflate our baits on the water like that with a guy 100 meters down, 100 meters up. And because it was my rock, I used a fishing blind position.
Okay. Oh, no. Remember Jim Duck and the boat Aqueduck?
Yeah, very well. I fished off Aqueduck. I'll tell you one day what happened. We went to go out with Jimmy, and Jimmy said, I've got to take some divers out, but I don't like that. I want to fish. I don't want to come take divers out. So we went down to Cape St. Francis, took the divers out. And the Wesley will came up. And this aqueduct was, it only had a freeboard about that.
Yeah.
Okay? So the waves were washing over us, coming back. He said, oh, stupid to ever get involved with the divers. Never again. But Jimmy Duck, when I saw the fishing, Jimmy Duck, the late Cindy Riley, Alfie Cadle, I don't know, Alfie, the last time I saw him, he was 93, and he was a stalwart, he was still quite fit for his age. I hope I can pass his age. I don't know if he's still alive. Does anybody know if Alfie Cadle was alive? I would like to know. I know he was staying in the old age home. I would really like to know.
There we go. So awesome to hear about the good old days. It says family 47 years already. May God bless you.
Lucille Tesler.
Lucille Tesler.
She married my late wife's, his mother.
Okay.
You know, sister-in-law.
Sister-in-law, okay. Anthony Halgren saying, do you remember my dad, Mike Halgren?
Oh, Andy Halgren. His father was...
Mike
Halgren
yeah.
from the Deep Sea Club.
Okay, there we go. What do you think of what do you think happened to the tuna in the Eastern Cape over the period?
The tuna haven't gone down. Yeah. It's just becoming more and more expensive. You know, to do a day's fishing now, you can burn up to 15,000 rands of the field.
Jeez, like
for tuna. Wow. Very, very expensive.
Expensive to get out there.
Very expensive. Because you're going to go 40, 50 miles and you don't stop, you throw lures all day.
Yeah.
You go out 5 o'clock in the morning, you come back 4 o'clock in the morning. 4 o'clock in the afternoon,
I was gonna say, right?
You burn an extreme amount of fuel.
Yeah, yeah.
And especially with the bigger motors, although today they got 4 strokes today, which are a third of what we used to use on 2 strokes.
Yeah.
But it's expensive. The Tuna Classic today, you burn 5-6 grand a day for the fuel.
Yeah, and I've got those big boats, and they got of course the what's the story with the radar stories, or whatever they call it, the sonar, whatever they use, the fish finders and that sort of thing.
Fish finders can only send a beam from your boat to the bottom to tell you how deep you are. If there's any fish in between, it'll show it.
Okay.
Just say that's your screen. That's the middle of your screen.
Yeah.
In the middle of your screen, you know they're halfway to the bottom. Okay. If they're right here, then they're on the bottom, and those are bottom feeders, and these are the game fish in the middle.
Okay.
And the game you can't fish without a sonar today.
Yeah.
A fish finder. It actually tells you where the reefs are. 90% of the fish we catch are all on reefs.
Okay.
Cave fish, tuna, leer fish are not reef fish. Yeah. They are surface fish.
Yeah.
They fish near the surface, they feed near the surface, but the punch carp, the carb, the stembras, they all fish, they all at the bottom.
Okay, gee whiz. And I think it was a story you told me about the oak that fell off the boat.
Okay.
Tell me that story. That
we were fishing in Cape Town.
Yeah.
And it was a very poor day in Cape Town, which is really, we catch a lot of longfin dunny in Cape Town. And this day, nobody caught a fish. And most of the boats were running home because it's uplines at 3 o'clock. And about 2 o'clock, there's no fish, the boats were starting. So we were running things, but some guys were trolling, so we put a troll. When you get about 10 miles from Cape Point, we normally put a line and run in. And we were about 50 miles off Cape Town, and the boat next time we went, zee! I said, I look at this boat. It's not that right. Is that boat there? And those days when you used to hook a longfin tuna, they used to open the boat and go, woo, to go fast and slow. And as he took his boat out the guy went, woo, and the fish was pulling, and he actually went over the back of the boat, fell in the water. And because no fish were caught that day, the guys were shouting on the boat, Munini first one worldly! How fast Munini! But he was in the water. And the other guys had to put in all their lines before they could go and pick him up. So we stopped the boat to see if we couldn't give a hand to get the guy.
Yeah.
And he actually got on the boat and he landed the fish.
Jeez.
The only fish in the whole competition.
Yeah.
The fish went around that competition.
Yeah.
But it was, we were hosing ourselves. They,
yes,
and to get him on the boat, he had a southwest on. They actually put a cap in him and they pull him in and they lived there and he was still, had the fish on and he landed the fish.
Put the cap on him.
It was hilarious. They wanted more about, not about the guy, about the fish.
About the fish.
Well, that's fishing. That was really hilarious.
And tell me, I mean, up to 70K, I mean, that's a hell of a long way out. I mean, how do you find your way back in these things? I mean,
well,
you always have...
you don't see land once you go over 18 miles.
Yeah.
The land disappears. When we go out 18 miles on them for the... university gets shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter. Eventually, you just see a better university, and when it disappears, we're 18 to 20 miles out.
Wow, okay.
But the late Cindy Clark and I went out one day, we went 75 miles out. We crossed the Gunners Cousin another current that was running opposite to the Gallus current.
Where are those currents around about?
Our first current is the Gallus current. It averages between 40 and 26 miles off our coast.
Wow.
And you know when you come to the edge of the current, the sea is rough. The sea is actually running. And once you get the other side of the current, the sea becomes calm and flat. Because you're going, it's actually flowing. It's like a river.
Yeah.
And we used to try and keep in the same area. So we'll throw down, 1 hour down and 3 hours up. Then we more or less be the same. But it will still push us. And by the end of the day, you leave there about 3 o'clock, you're 20 miles south towards, nearer to Cape St. Francis than what you are at Cape St. Francis.
Wow.
So you've got to come all the way almost from Cape St. Francis.
Against the current, you're trying to go up from the current when you get to the storm.
When you get to the current, you ride up current.
Okay.
And then you drive down, you'll drive 3 hours up, 1 hour down. 3 hours up, 1 hour. But most of the fish feed on the edge of the current. Because that's where all the feed is.
Okay.
Sometimes you see the goldfish flying out the water and a big tuna, 100 pound tuna, 200 pound tuna, or 50 kilo pound tuna will come out of the water and actually take the goldfish in their head. And when they do that, you throw through that shell, if you've got one line out or 10 lines out, all the rods go.
All go.
But you normally four on the boat, you have one short one and one long one.
Okay.
But all my big tuna I've caught in all my life has always been well behind the boat.
Yeah.
Where the old fish don't swim with the smaller fish, and the bigger fish are always behind. That 85 kilo tuna I caught in Fungatani at Cape St. Francis, I was at least 200 meters behind the boat.
Wow.
And I used a big cone and I caught him. And when he got it, one hook was in the eye and the other hook on the side of the body. So he had no chance to escape.
Okay. how many of your family members fish that? Is it all three of you guys?
My family is David, who's in Joburg now, Ray and myself.
Yes.
But I had a lot of friends who used to fish with me, Pancho fish with me for many, many years. Great angler, great friend, and he's quite a scream on the boat. I like that. And I had so many guys fishing on my boat over the 25 years, I can't remember them all. But we were always happy-go-lucky, catch fish, good. Don't catch fish, fine. Tomorrow's another day.
Yeah. Now, Ray, you've got a couple of records under your belt as well.
First
record at 14. South African record, junior record.
See, as fortunate as I had opportunity.
Yeah.
How many guys can say that every single weekend, Saturday and Sunday, they could go fishing with their dad?
Yeah.
So I had opportunity.
Yeah.
But catching records was a lot of work to claim them. And eventually, I actually claimed 4 SA records and 1 All Africa record.
Okay.
And then it got to a stage where it's like, why bother?
Yeah.
In my matric year, I actually broke 12 unclaimed SA records.
Didn't bother claiming them.
I had opportunity.
Yeah. And David also?
David wasn't as lucky as I was when it came to that. I was much luckier.
As I say, when we used to catch lively near the breakwater, for about 3 years, the first rod went off was always right. And when he says, I don't know why I'm so lucky, you know, I always get the first rod. The first thing David said, whoa, now you're going to break your hoodoo now. Now you really can put a hoodoo on yourself. You're going to break your luck. And it happened. It took many, many weeks or a year or two before he got the first fish.
He got another one again.
But he had luck, man. I must say, the fishing gods have been good to me. I've had a lot of luck. I've caught a lot of beautiful fish in my time. And I'm born under the Pisces side.
The two fish as well.
So maybe that's something to do.
Yeah, and the twin,
Yeah.
The twin as well. Worst weather you've ever encountered?
Coming back from Bird Island, 7 hours in an easterly that was coming more over the boat. And we were going more through waves and going over them. 7 hours to do 32 sea miles.
Wow. I mean, that must be a bit scary then. I mean,
scary. Yeah. I'll tell you something. When you come to St. Croix, you get behind the lee of the island, but the wind is screaming 14 knots. And I don't know if you've ever seen this harbour, bay, what it looks like in the sun.
No, it's heavy.
It's heavy.
And what and this size here is that size.
It comes from you like that, and you've got to go over the top, and as you go down, and then wave pushes you back, and then you go over the top, and you're making so slow headway. And then you eventually get behind St. Croix, and everybody takes a minute. But when you're going through the big seas, nobody's chatting. Yes, nobody's laughing. Everybody's just
checking around. What's coming? I mean, there must be big sea that. I mean,
big sea.
Probably,
The worst sea I've ever been in, other than in Cape Town.
Yeah. So we've had some fun experiences on the boat, and we've had some scary experiences on the boat.
Hairy, mate.
I remember we went out fishing the one day to what we call the crayfish banks, which is south of Cape Reef.
Okay.
We used to fish in 110 meters of water. So we used to let out sometimes up to 300 meters of anchor rope out in order to anchor on there.
Yeah.
So this particular day, you never really know how strong the current is until you've put hook down.
Okay.
Put hook down, boat settled with quick speed, and we knew, hang on, this current is going.
Yeah.
Running
And we caught fish. Came time to go home, we caught a fair amount of fish.
Yeah.
We used to use what they call a buoy with a ring around the rope. Yeah. What happens is you ride against the rope, that buoy is pushed back by the water, and that actually lifts the anchor up for you.
Ah.
It saves you having to pull by hand. You use two or three guys to pull, once it's on the water, one guy pulls it in.
Yeah.
So this particular day, the anchor got stuck. And it didn't want to come out. And I remember it on Sea Princess. We had two Yamaha 150s on the back.
Yeah.
We got to a stage where my dad was flat out. The buoy went down, and we weren't going anywhere. And Mike Fafirin was actually on the boat with us that day. And the sea was also big as well. And the rope is attached to the front of the boat.
Okay.
So as you come up, that rope will want to pull the nose over. So you've got to be careful for that.
Yes.
So we released a little bit of pressure, pulled back a bit. Eventually the buoy came up. Second attempt, my dad says, pull it around where you used to have a cleat on the back of the boat, put it around there. So we're pulling from the back of the boat rather than the front of the boat.
Yes, okay.
Less chance of being pulled over.
Yes, jeez.
Second time it happened, went even further, harder, pulled back. The boat started pulling back. The motors are actually being pulled under the water.
Under the water, doing like that. Water really on the deck.
And by now, there's an extreme amount of worry, and people know.
Yeah. Down the water on the deck.
Situation.
So,
my dad said to Fires at the time, he said, Fires, grab a knife.
Yeah.
If it doesn't come off this time,
cut.
Hold and cut. Yeah. We're going to jump. But hold on, don't go overboard. And we pulled it, and it was, we were, any moment we thought, okay, we're going to have to cut the throat. Because you can imagine if you flat out with two big 150s, and all of a sudden you release the pressure, that boat jumps, flies. And we thought any moment now we're going to have to cut. The next thing, you felt the ass lift up, and the anchor line came loose. But it's probably one of the most scary.
We battled for almost an hour to get an anchor lift that day.
It's something that makes you respect the sea even more.
Because it's and obviously it's stuck with something under there.
I was never scared of the sea, but I respected it.
Yeah.
You've got to respect the sea.
Was that you reckon that? What's your most exciting fishing adventure that you've had?
I had so many.
No.
I love fishing in Cape Town. For Longfin Tuna, won many competitions there.
Yeah.
I actually made a name for myself in Cape Town because I won many competitions there. And we used to have a Masters tournament for many years.
Yeah.
And I've never won the Masters. The closest I came was third.
Yeah.
I had three thirds and a fourth.
Okay.
And I had a big fishing gate down of 65 pound tuna in the Masters on 6 kg. And I stood a strong chance to win it. Then I caught another fish and I fought him 2 hours. And eventually got in the boat and the line passed. But it came down. I've been through terrible seas in Cape Town.
Yeah, okay.
And then you get a skipper that, when you're a skipper long enough, you know exactly how to ride the sea.
Yeah.
And he kept on hitting the sea on a beam, and the water was coming over.
Yeah.
And that's a dangerous play. Rather ride in the sea, into the sea like that.
Okay.
In a big sea. That's okay. Takes longer.
Long with the wave, but it
can save your life.
Yeah.
Like that day, he's talking about many a boat at Cape Recife, off the point, when they can't get the anchor loose, it actually turns the boat on the side and the boat doubles over.
Really?
It's happened to quite a few guys already. Yeah. And then you come there, but the boat can't sink. Because all boats are fighting for it.
Yes, yes.
So the guys can sit on the top and you're going to now,
then
you put them on your boat and now you're going to try and pull that boat over.
Yeah.
It's virtually impossible.
Yeah.
The water holds that boat.
And, yes, yes. And have you had to do that before? Have you
capsized the boat? No, I've never capsized the boat, but I've been close.
I've had the unfortunate process for me.
Oh, really?
You've been on the boat when I turned the boat on the side? Were you on the boat?
No, that was another story altogether. I was unfortunate to flip a boat in the river mouth of Swartkops.
Oh, yes, sir. That must be as dangerous that day. It can go wrong.
That particular day...
lost all your tackle, nearly lost your life.
We went out... We were very fortunate in the sense of... When we went out, the capsized boy, you got a capsized boy with all your flares and your safety equipment in an airtight bottle. So if you go down, obviously things stay dry.
Okay.
As the boat went over, the capsized bottle was in one of the hatches.
Oh.
And boats turn turtle. Now, obviously, that you got this boy, which is about a 20-litre drum, roughly.
Yeah.
And underneath, you got to pull it down.
You put it down and
almost
out.
A metre down to get it up again.
My soul, yeah.
And you know how heavy it is. You try and push a 20-litre bottle down. It's fortunately attached by a rope.
Yeah.
Don't know how we got it out, but we got it out. We shot off our rocket flare.
Yeah.
Rocket flare went up. The harbour master in the harbour tower actually saw it before anyone else.
Wow.
Radioed NSRI. They had just arrived, the Swartkops, to do a mock rescue.
Oh, no way.
So
a real rescue.
So we were very lucky in that instance.
Absolutely.
I put a boat on the side.
Okay. You
know, fishing in the rock at Cape St. Francis at
Bird Island.
And the rock is called Southwest Reef. And you always yell a tail around that reef.
Yeah.
But the rock only sticks out that far at low tide, and at high tide it covers. But we know where the rock is.
Yes.
So we trot around and around.
Yeah.
And that day was quite a big swell running. And as when that swell pulled a boat in the winter and it lay on its side.
Yeah.
And the glass still broke, and a piece of glass went up my arm. And I couldn't get it out. But anyway, they took it out to the P hospital.
Like
because the blood.
Glass or glass?
No,
it's a glass.
Glass from the
glass.
From the window.
From the window, she's like.
But eventually, another wave came in and put us back on a keel. Cut all around your window.
Yes, I'm sure. At least it got home. That's the phrase at the most.
My friend Benjo says, what is that sheet?
What is the screen? do you consider yourself particularly lucky with all this stuff?
No, but I had a lot of luck. God has been good to me already.
Do you have any rituals and superstitions as well? You don't?
I don't believe in those things.
Nothing like that. Except for a race thing where you didn't. He had lucky first strike for a while, but then he voodooed himself.
something called karma.
Fishermen have a lot of superstitions. If the moon is this way or that way,
they do that.
I don't believe in that. Just fish, man.
Fish. tell me the strangest or funniest thing that's ever happened out at sea.
Oh, I can't even remember. The funniest one was in Cape Town. Munini first will
work. Yeah, yeah, yeah. over the top. And I think if anything on the boat that you've regretted, that you've done that you've regretted later on?
Not really. Yeah. I remember once David had a hockey competition, yeah, and we went to bed.
David was a good hockey player, I remember that.
Yeah. And they won the competition in high school, and they all got drunk on Old Brown that night.
That sounds like 88
metrics. And the next morning we went to St. Croix Island, and he was scotching, and all you could smell is Old Brown.
Old Brown.
Oh, and I hate the smell.
Old Brown.
Old Brown.
David, you know, honestly.
And he was scotching. I said, yeah, you bugger. Punish.
Punish
you
me.
Know you're going to my own one, what do you want to, but they won the competition. And once you start going with the Old Brown, you
No, it's like a
so Old Brown and me are not good friends.
Eddie Brecken. Any Rybank stories?
I had a problem with the Rybank. I actually capsized at the Rybank. You know about it, right?
No.
Is that a boat?
A big boat came up there and they actually pulled me straight.
Oh, is it?
And we right away, we pulled the drain plugs out and you ride, and when you pull the drain plugs, all the bar water runs out underneath the boat.
Oh, awesome.
You got foam, but you also got cavities.
Yeah.
Run everything off. Then you quickly dive out of the sun, you put the brain back.
The thing's back in. Come, yeah. Shut up, strike,
and
shut
you
up,
might have 20, 30 litres. Yeah. But I actually capsized and this commercial boat helped me and pulled me out.
Wow.
That was very hairy.
I mean, it must be a lot of that out at sea. I mean, there's no other help. So other vessels come and help you if there's trouble, quick.
That's one thing about the fishing community. It doesn't matter who you are.
Yeah.
If a boat's in trouble, all
everybody
helps.
Everybody
helps. The guys can
be huge.
10 miles away can I help?
Yeah. Can I get there?
But the guy 500 meters away, if he's there first, he helps.
He helps.
I was capsized next to the island.
Okay.
Also, when the water pulling in the boat fell over.
Yo.
And we were sitting on top of the boat, and the boat came past, we waved, he came past, and he just ran away.
Maybe he didn't see what was going on.
And I was astounded. And then 20 minutes later, he comes back and we waved him. Oh, there he only saw us. I said, but didn't you see us next to the island? We were from here next to the island, being ready to bash up against the island.
I was pulling in the elephant.
But the water washed in eventually. So they actually towed the boat upside down back to the island. It is right.
I thought you said you didn't capsize.
No.
Towing the boat upside down counts as that.
No, but we were all on a rescue boat. He called rescue.
Okay.
And rescue. But they towed the boat upside down to the island. When they got up there, they put something at the bottom and they turned the boat around and drained the boat and eventually got the boat. I was in the capsize boat. It's not nice. Hey?
No, I'm sure. Yes, and when it actually happens, I mean, if injuries, you can be concussed and God knows what. Yep. Cade Rodocanachi there says, I remember catching fish the size of me on Freedom Still. What's Freedom Still?
So no, Freedom was the boat.
That's his son.
My son, which was his first fish that he caught. I think he was about 6 or 7.
He caught one of the same size as
he caught a learfish, the Garrick.
There we go. Following the family tradition.
He wasn't strong enough to hold the fish. So for the photograph, we had to hang the fish so he could stand next to
him. Classic. I love it, man. I love it. Vanna Buerta, Uncle George, you taught me to ride a ski boat. Only 2 speeds, flat out or dead stop. I remember when we went to BL on Michaela B.
Yeah, Bird Island.
BI. On Michaela B. There we go. David says it was the Nationals from Houghton Bay, the killer whale chasing the longfin at the gaff. The skipper thrust the boat forward and it would have landed just where you guys were.
Yes, yeah. That was a Madeira.
Yeah.
We were finding the longfin, and next thing the killer whale came and he actually took this,
yes,
and sir, his head hit the back of the gunnel like a squam, and smashed the gunnel.
Wow.
The place where we put our rods, he smashed that. But The skipper saw it and he opened, but only half his head hit the gunnel. If he hit the diggers, he would have put that hole, but he was a massive digger.
So the skipper actually saw it and pulled away.
He could see him coming out, so he opened that digger. But if he never, he would have landed on top of that boat and probably pushed it. Okay. And we were 45 miles out to sea.
Yo! Holy moly, that is...
And he still had the fish in his mouth.
He's like...
He had it across his mouth. He came up and he... Well, only half his head and the tuna jumped out of his mouth. He must have got hurt because we never saw him again.
Okay.
But the back of the boat was damaged.
Yo.
That wasn't so lovely. 40 miles out to sea, you go out there and they don't find you.
Yeah, no, for sure. Jeez, Brian Wilkinson says, did George know Bert Thomas and Tommy Horn?
Yes, Bert Thomas, they both called the Ampere.
Yeah, Ampere.
Yep.
Yeah.
In the 50s and 60s.
Yeah, there you are. There you are.
The Ampere, yeah.
That's where I learned to fish deep sea. That's where I got the love for deep sea.
Really?
From the Ampere, yeah.
Thomas, Bert and Tommy.
Yeah.
Bert Thomas and Tommy Horn. Here we go.
Yeah.
George Rodocanachi, Brian Hart and Nick DeComa.
Nick DeCock. It was Nick DeCock and Brian Hart. Brian Hart came from Durban. Also passed away. Nick DeCock is still alive in Cape Town. Nick, if you can see me now, best of luck. We fished in the Springbok team.
Put ears on everybody to take gold. What is that?
Put ears meaning to show everybody up.
Oh, really? I put ears. Is that like give horns?
Okay, well, Nick the Cock. You see, Nick the Cock. Yes, don't you go by
him. I saw that. Jan Boerter says, hello, George, long time, no see.
Jan Boerter.
Jan Boerter, yeah.
Goodness.
And Thijs Kun says, how's it, Uncle Georgie nearly lost you overboard at Van G and Tunny?
Fangitani. That big fish that he caught.
Yeah.
They tied me with the rope to a boat. Because that fish was stronger.
Is it?
It took me 4 hours to land it, but we hooked it 20 miles off the point. When we landed in, we could see straight to the harbour.
Yes.
That boat down is 21 miles. Huh?
Yo. Unbelievable.
That fish.
There's a picture there. What is that picture there, Ray? Can you see it?
So that was a dagger egg which I caught as a junior at the time.
Yeah.
You can actually, as far as I know, the record still stands.
Yeah.
It was 8.5 kgs.
Yeah, Jesus.
And as a junior at the time, the SA record was 8.7. Yeah. Had been standing since the 70s.
Wow.
And I think this was
7.7.
No, 8.5.
Yeah.
Okay.
That wasn't 8.7.
8.5.
The senior record.
Was 8.7, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I was that close.
Wow, to the senior record.
Yeah,
Jesus.
That's one of the SA records I did claim.
Okay.
Now,
okay.
One of the things they do when they measure the fish, they measure the length of the fish and they measure the girth.
Okay.
That gives them an understanding of how big and how fat it is. That fish's girth was actually more than its length.
Is it
the length was 600 millimeters?
Yeah.
And the girth was 700.
Jeez, like
this. It's a fish like this, you see.
They call them wagon wheels.
A pens.
They call them wagon wheels because they're almost around.
Yes, like that.
Amazing. There's George there with the leer fish.
Yeah.
World record.
Yeah, that was the 14.4 kg fish. That was one of his world records.
Wow.
Yeah.
And the sea princess there in the background.
4 kg.
That's unbelievable. Trio bags, 500 kilograms of off-season tunny. You.
Well, that was
some nice tiny steaks there come out of that.
Yeah. It was the 22nd of October, which is out of season for tuna.
Wow.
But I always said the tuna all year round you go.
Yeah.
So we don't want who was on the boat that day?
Cedric Riley and looked like Eric de Villiers.
Yeah, Eric and yeah. And we went back, what you going out for tunny for now? I said I want to experiment. I want to see if they're there. Because we had good Wesley's and the water was warm. And when we came to the current, he says, we're wasting our time. Let's go and catch carpenters, man. I said, listen, Eric doesn't, he only wants to catch goldfish. And he actually paid for it. Eric de Villiers, the lawyer.
Okay.
Go back in the Villiers.
Yes, yes.
Anyway, I said, Eric said he wants to go and catch tuna. And we got a first strike about 26 miles. And then thereafter, two fish, one fish. We caught 22 fish.
Yo.
We were back in the harbour by 3 o'clock. Very lovely. She come on, we proved the point. We've done it again in August.
Yeah, yeah.
That's why they call it off season.
Off season. Amazing, amazing that. I see there's I've also got some got a few little notes here as well. New Zealand, USA, Caribbean, Mediterranean. I mean, you've been all over the world with
this. Yeah. I fish in the Caribbean and the island called Catkay. They call it Catkay Island.
Yeah.
We could see Cuba.
Yeah.
That's how close we were to Cuba.
Yeah.
I caught a lot of sailfish there. The water was 92 degrees, so warm.
Yeah.
Crystal clear.
Yeah.
You could see 60 foot down.
Yeah.
You could see every rock, you could see the
fish.
Yeah, you could see the rock fish swimming around.
Amazing.
Crystal clear water. Beautiful. Yeah, but the clearest water I've seen in the world is when we went the fish are gone in the war.
The Marlin.
No, the swordfish. When you went to the swordfish, we would put a silent room light on a squid, go down 150 meters.
A light on a squid?
Yeah.
It's a glow stick.
Glow stick.
We put a silent room light on it. You know, you crack it, you shake it. And you put it about so far, you could see that light shining at 150 meters.
Yeah.
That's how clear that water is in the Gulf Stream. Or Fort Lauderdale.
Unbelievable. And I mean, did you fly over there to go to that?
Oh, yes, I was quite tired when I got there.
Yeah.
No, we went to...
you didn't do like a trip?
We went to Joburg, stopped at Ile de Sol, then for an hour or two, then we came to New York at Kennedy. We came there at 9 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
And... from there, we took another flight to Miami, which was another 1,300 miles south. And we fished in the Miami, and that's where we went for swordfish. That's where they caught the first, that's where they learned to catch the first swordfish. And when I came back from there, I gave a couple of seminars at the club, how to catch them, what to do. Mm-hmm. The first outing we went, I caught the first swordfish ever caught in South Africa.
Yeah.
It's on my wall now, in B. And we caught three fish. Eric Villiers got one. I can't even remember who got the other one. I got the first one. Eric got one. But they weren't big fish, but we caught swordfish, which was never done before in South Africa, except the longliners.
Okay.
Not run real fishing, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was quite exciting. But we went out seven boats and we caught three fish. And coming back, we caught quite a few tuna coming back the morning. Because we spend the night out there, it's night fishing.
Yeah, okay.
You fish in the pitch dark, you're fishing there, and you actually hold your line.
Yeah.
And you feel a bump. The moment you feel the bump, you know, a swordfish is now eat your fish, your bait.
Yeah.
And then you keep your rod. The moment you feel your rod go there, that fish is very, very strong.
Yeah, okay.
Because you're fishing from deep, and he's in his atmosphere, and you're in yours.
Yeah, yeah.
But those here, they have been known. Big 500-600 pounders come up to daytime to digest their fish on the surface.
Okay.
Especially in Fort Lauderdale, where fish they used to see them. That's why they learned to fish for them.
Yeah. Okay. So
and in that competition, they had a fish of 660 pounds. A massive fish. his head probably would have been up there. The bull and the tail.
It's like 4 meters up.
and he was that size. Massive fish.
And tell me, I've got breakable diving with Tony Dix and Mike Lindenberg.
I learned a lot of
you dive. Brain. You dive as well?
Yeah, I used to dive. I learned from a guy, Ger Bauer. Oh, not Ger Bauer, what was his name? And that before you would even.
Yeah, so I wouldn't be able to help you with that.
You're still not even a thought.
Maybe the guys online will know. Colin Barris, I see, he's online as well. How's it, Colin?
Anyway, this Bauer guy, He used to dive. He used to go with us to go to France. He used to dive and we used to fish for sharks.
Okay.
And then he got me interested and I started diving.
Why don't you just hook him up to your light?
Yeah. And I must tell you another story about the big squid we found.
Yeah.
Anyway, and that's where I learned to dive. And we used to dive in breakwater.
Yeah.
You go 15 meters on the breakwater. It's always deep next to the water and it comes out there 20 meters out. Got a big sandbank.
Okay.
The first time in my life I've seen so many fish.
Yeah, on the sandbank there.
White steelmass, muskrat, white span.
Yes, sir.
200 fish. And they all fish like that.
Jeez.
Like so it is. And you come up there, and I wanted to shoot a white steelmass. And I shot and I missed and hit the muscle cracker. Anyway, as you go, they're gone. They're just gone.
Disappear.
But by that time, the spears already hit the fish.
Yes.
And then I saw the same at Cape St. Francis. But I will tell you about, was it you or David? That he has a big octopus in the water.
No, that was David.
Okay. He's a youngster, two, 3 years. Daddy is a big octopus in the water. I went to there was a squid that weighed 28 pounds.
Yes.
It was that eye and that thick.
Yes.
Squid. They catch him in some parts of the world that big.
Yo.
So we brought him back to the ocean here. That flesh was that thick.
Yo.
When they cut him open to see what he was eating.
You meaning to calamari steak, eh?
Yeah. It's that big steak, so can I make like a, it's like a Texan calamari
anyway,
steak.
Anyway, they gave me some
tomahawk.
It was so tough. I didn't know how to cook it, but I know how to. I can make you a calamari pickle that when you chew it, it's softer than bread.
Is it?
Yeah. But it's a seed. You've got to put it in a pressure cooker. When it starts going, psh,
yeah.
10 minutes you take him out, when you pick him up, he falls apart.
So okay, the pressure cooker, that's a proper 70s, 80s.
If you ever come to my house, I'll give you some pickled calamari.
Calamari, is that the way?
Beautiful.
Is it lekker?
I still got some.
Lekker.
I got some.
Man. Okay, I think it's probably nearly time for getting to know you. I don't know if Gary's got any more questions here. We've got Trevor Valletti is in the background too. I see Colin Barris, maybe a couple of comments. Colin Barris is here as well, and his son is also fishing now as well, I see.
Yeah.
Colin is also a very good friend of mine.
Yes.
He bought quite a few reels in America, American reels for me.
Oh, lovely.
Imported them for me.
Lovely.
How's it, Colin?
He's done my solar panels here as well. Shireen Clarkson says, how's it? Uncle George taught me to fish. The only spot was left was between the motors, and I must say I caught a nice-sized fish, he says. She only had a little space between the motors that she could stay there, but she still caught a nice fish.
I can't remember.
Shireen.
Oh, she was class. Isn't
yes,
okay.
Class, yes. And so which other Eastern Cape fishermen do you respect? I mean, maybe if you had mentors.
Oh, they were very good fishermen in the Eastern Cape, eh?
Yeah.
I'm too old to remember now. I'll be really honest.
Yeah.
If I go back in photographs, I'll say, well, that is so, that's Cedric Riley, that is the Alf Cadel.
Was there like a mentor or somebody that taught you?
No, I taught myself. I experimented. Like when I caught off fish in Dali, I said, you man, what do you want to go south for? I said, I'm going to go catch Dali. Nobody believed me. Came back with 22 fish. After that, they started fishing in August. We used to wait for April, May, which is more tuna time than any other time.
Okay.
That's why they have the tuna cancer in May.
Yeah.
But I made statements many times. I've cancelled it again.
Yeah.
Best time for the Tudor Classic. Listen, guys, you're listening. First week in June.
First week in June.
Good weather, lots of fish.
Oh, lekker.
Small currents. Listen to me. I know I'm right.
Lots of fish, small currents, good weather.
Yeah.
Who lies the most about their fish? Trevor.
I wouldn't like to mention his name, but
you know.
We call him Plate Face.
He's always looking for a plate.
A lot of guys will know who I'm talking about, but I can't mention his name.
Did Fias van Vuren have a nickname or a reason that he was too scared to come on the show himself here tonight?
I have the best respect for Fias. For many people, he's a great person.
Oh, you have a nickname? What is his nickname?
On our boat, he was called the Mule.
The Mule.
Because he was big and he was strong.
Yeah.
But
he
still had a lot to learn. Let's put it that way. My dad actually made a mule out of brass and inlaid it into the wooden gunnel at his fishing spot, and he used to fish over the mule.
Mule gunnel, fish in your spot.
Georgie, world class, he says. This is Gino, you have one of the greatest fishing legends in the world. He's known worldwide.
I fish many places. Yeah. New Zealand, Australia, Honolulu, south of India. They catch marlin south of India. Wow. I fish in the Caribbean for tuna. I fish south of France. I wanted to go to the Great Barrier Reef, but it never happened. And it was very expensive to fish there, and I couldn't get a booking on the boat. So I came back to South Africa. But that's before he was born.
Okay.
When he had money.
Before
Masterman took my money.
Yes, Masterman. Because you were a watchmaker, you said before.
I started the Albert Rock when I was 17. I wanted to become a doctor. I had 7 distinctions in matric.
Jeez,
I couldn't get a scholarship to go to university. My father worked on the railway, he couldn't afford it. Yeah. So I did the thing I loved most, working on mechanics.
So
I became a watchmaker. And I was very wealthy at one stage, but I lost a lot of money. But I ended up with 3 jewelry shops. When I sold the 3, I invested. I don't want to mention the bank. They said,
"Oh, you could say Master Bond." There's a lot of people here.
Invest your money in Master Bond. It's as safe as a house. Yeah. It's so safe that I lost my house.
Yeah, but you know, life.
7.2 million rand I lost,
and that back then, eh?
That's a lot of money. I would have been very wealthy today. I wouldn't have been alive.
your life doesn't revolve around money in the end. It's about what you, it's about your family and about your friends and your fishing, which you clearly love, you know. So
I've had a good life.
Yeah.
I wouldn't change it for the world. Yeah. I've got 2 beautiful sons.
Yeah.
Claudelle is my daughter.
Okay.
From my first marriage, she was born deaf. She's still deaf.
Yes.
And she's sending comments, but she can lip read very well.
There's also the Facebook Claudelle. I see the Facebook thing here. I hope it works nicely for you as well, for the guys that are deaf. I've actually had people before asking about it, and I think Facebook does it automatically.
So glad. Because now she can hear what we're talking about.
Yes, well, she can read it. She must be.
And her husband is deaf, and she's got a deaf boy as well.
Okay.
But he speaks very well.
Okay.
And she went to Catholic school.
Yeah.
He came down to Dominic School for the Deaf.
Uh-huh.
I never sent her to. There was a place outside of Cape Town.
Worcester.
Yeah.
I never sent her there. I could afford to send her to a good school. And she did a matric there. And she worked for many firms. She's very bright.
Sure.
And I love it to bits.
Yeah.
And she knows I love her.
Is there anything left on your fishing bucket list?
I don't think so.
You've done everything.
I think so.
Do you look back with nostalgia on those days as well?
Well, I couldn't have chosen a better sport. I would never have played bowls. I was always too small for rugby. I played a bit of cricket, but I couldn't have done a better sport for me. Because I was never ever a big strong guy, but I was strong in my fishing. Let me put it this way.
Everybody needs to find that little niche or that thing that they can.
I love catching fish. What put me on the road when I was 6 years old and I caught that big mullet.
Yeah.
And no fish has ever been caught in
cookhouse
of that size ever.
Just lots of cook.
That's where all the cake is.
Yeah, I see it. Yeah. Are you still active with the fishing now? Are you still going
out again? No. I've sold my boat, my swim. Yeah. You know, you come to saturation point.
Yeah.
But I would still like to go and catch a lady. I spoke to Tues and I said, take me out there. I would love to catch a lady. You know?
Yeah.
And sometimes I think of buying a rubber duck and going catching a lady myself.
Ray's going to roll his eyes soon. The thought of you riding a rubber duck around.
Make sure it's got your seagull motor on.
Put in the seagull. I think you should be catching some rock bullies with your grandchildren. Have you got some grandchildren?
I've got grandchildren, yes.
Yes, yeah. How many grandchildren then you got?
I've got
four, five, six
grandchildren, yeah.
Six of them. And do they like fishing as well?
No,
they're not bloody interested, man.
Even Cade, I couldn't get him into fishing.
Is it?
And his father loved fishing. David loved fishing. My boys, they don't want to fish.
You failed in that department there.
Funny. They chase you in the cookhouse.
Yeah. funny enough, Kate actually started asking to go fishing. So I think he's starting to...
Oh, there we go.
Maybe he gets him an interest.
You know?
Maybe he was by a boat.
Kate, he's watching now. You better ask your grandpa now for his advice. You know, and his tricks.
Tell your dad to buy a boat and we go off his. You have the expensive bonds. I'll just pay the petrol.
Well, you can call it Master Bond 2. Those expensive, these boats.
No, it hurt me. It killed me. You know?
Yeah, I'll tell you. A bucket list. We're going to catch a lariat humor, Georgie. He says, Michael, that's fires.
Oh.
Fires.
Oh.
He says you're going to go to humor and catch a
lariat.
Well,
I'm telling you, I can go there tomorrow morning, and I guarantee I'll catch an airfish if I can catch a mullet, if I can catch an elf.
Whereabouts in you would you go there?
You know where the ropes are?
Yeah.
There's a little rock there, and the ropes go that way, those big blocks.
Where it used to be the tower there.
Yes, yeah.
But tomorrow there's going to be 10,000 people there.
Ah, that's a problem, mate. That's a problem. You used to turn the bugger off.
Anyway.
It's a shark! Shark!
They shot the airfish amongst those big bricks. Those bricks used to launch the boats through there. That used to be a place to repair fishing boats.
The old dry dock.
Yeah.
The old dry dock. Yeah. They shot the airfish there of 39 pounds or something.
No, 26 kilos or something. 26
kilos?
A massive fish. Spearfish. Spearfish. They shot another one now.
Yeah.
Awesome big. I don't know what's on.
I see some axe there. I always wonder if I'm swimming around there, they're shooting their blood.
There's a lot of we used to throw around the point of the breakwater.
Yeah.
And then if it gets quiet, we used to go all along down the breakwater, round the back line of King's Beach, and turn there by the niggas and go back again. And yes, I caught many fish between that rock where I'm talking about with the ropes are and the breakwater itself.
Jeez, John Allen is saying, and I remember you mentioned earlier, George and his dancing prowess at Arthur Murray. So this is a bit of a dancer.
Yeah, well, I became a dancing teacher when I was 16.
A dancing teacher as well?
Yeah. Well, I had a knack for dancing. I still love dancing.
Yeah, yeah.
Even today, I love dancing.
Your son's not following suit?
When I see him, Raven was 8, David was 11 or something.
Yeah.
I said, listen, you're going with me, Arthur Murray. Who's Arthur Murray? I said, I'm going to teach you to dance. No! Daddy, I'm not a singer. I said, it's not ballet.
It's not ballet, it's dancing. You know? Daddy says, did George fish with Bobby Bush from Jay Bay?
Yes, yes.
Bobby Bush.
Yeah.
Who was that?
Bobby Boer. He used to go out at Jeffrey's Bay.
Okay.
I fished a competition or two with Bobby Bush,
okay,
mate.
Okay.
And there'll be a lot of guys that know me now. If they come along, I can tell you.
Yes, Sean Clark.
That's one of my grandson.
The grandson says, legend, Opa and Uncle Ray. Lekker to see you guys. God willing to see you guys again. It's good to get to know you. Thank you, Gino, for the live stream. It's a pleasure. And I see this, he's put on another one there as well. And Claudette as well, also there too, saying how's it too. But I think what we must do is we must go and we're going to do a couple, just a few of these getting to know you questions. Because we'll go because there's other stuff that you do, like the dancing. And is there anything else that you're interested in? Or
dancing and fishing, that's all.
Dancing and fishing.
And having.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you.
Mandarin or go.
The Mandarin Inn.
Yeah, we used to dance here on Friday, Saturday night.
You go to Manetti.
No, too far. I don't drink and drive.
Oh, okay.
If I go there and I have too many drinks, I leave my car and I catch a taxi.
Okay. Oh, good.
No, don't drink and drive.
Because the oldies are normally like, it's all right, we'll take a chance. You know, but clearly you're okay with that.
Yeah, I was called for drunk and driving.
Oh, that's a long time ago.
And my doctor disappeared and I got off.
Okay, lucky for you.
And can I tell you something? Yeah. I was about 10 meters from home.
Yo, really? Oh my goodness. So yeah, those are life lessons.
I hope you're gonna cut that one.
No, we'll push mute on it. Yeah, it's fine. Now listen, there's a lot of my guests that come on that have been to jail. Have you ever been to jail?
Never.
Yeah.
Do you visit Ryan Mel now?
Oh yeah.
That's only jokes, you guys.
Yes, no, because quite a few of my guests have been in jail before. Yeah. A little night here and there. Oh man. Is there something that you ever get tired of? Is there something that you're tired of it now? That's it. Your fishing is not.
No, I never ever got tired of fishing. I can still fish for the rest of my life.
Dancing, not.
No, I love dancing. We used to go out and I could dance with 20 different women. But funny enough, Andrina, his mother,
yes,
she danced with me, but she had two left feet. Now I've been with a woman for 15 years.
Yeah.
She doesn't like dancing, but I can dance whoever I like.
Okay, that's all right.
No jealousy, right. Nothing.
Oh, good.
I don't dance fast, I dance away.
Oh, lekker.
And I can swing him. I taught many a youngster when I was young to dance.
To dance as well. Okay, yeah. So dancing is a
And when thing. I wanted to thank him, I thought they're going to ballet.
Yeah. What's the most uncomfortable place you've ever slept?
Cape St. Francis.
Is it? Those rocks there?
No, yeah, on the rocks. When you went out, I forgot my blanket and I thought I'm going to die of cold at night. I was freezing. I got in my Land Rover, started the car and put the heater on.
Yeah.
I still couldn't. In the morning, I was like, frozen.
No petrol and frozen.
No, we always had enough fuel, eh?
And
I could always get fuel at the lighthouse.
Okay.
Many people got left behind, but the lighthouse keeper was.
Okay. That was a good idea.
Something Gordon, I can't remember.
Oh, man. Is that the shark hut?
No, the shark hut was mine.
Oh, is that yours? Yes. Jan Boete says, what about the shark hut?
Yeah, I built the shark hut.
Okay, was that an uncomfortable place
rocks,
to sleep?
On the rocks. Today there's a big house in front of it.
Oh, is it? It's still there?
Yeah.
Oh, look at it.
No, not the hut.
Yeah.
They broke it down.
Oh, okay, all right. That was the...
And I got into trouble for cutting a road through Cape St. Francis lighthouse to get behind the rocks. And then The Cape St. Francis Housing Committee wanted to send me to jail.
Oh, you're lucky.
For illegally cutting a road.
Oh,
but it wasn't long. That put Cape St. Francis on the map.
Yeah.
When I caught a big shark at Cape St. Francis Far Point.
Yeah.
And late in Europe could see the potential.
Yeah.
But the guys at the lighthouse side were very upset because I was getting houses for sale at Leighton Hewlett's place and not the day place.
Oh, I see. Oh, no. And how do you relax? How do you decompress?
I watch a movie or something, or I put on a fishing movie or read a good book. That's how I relax. Okay. But I'm a bad sleeper. I wake up 2-3. I wake up at 20 past 2 this morning. I went to sleep at 10 to 4. I'm a bad sleeper.
Okay.
But I don't get overexcited. I'm a pleasant person.
Yeah.
Always been a pleasant person.
Favorite food?
Fish.
Fish. favorite dessert?
Ice cream.
You like
the
ice cream?
The best food in the world is ice cream.
Is that?
Why are there 20 billion people eating ice cream right now?
Yeah. You're right. What brings you at the moment? So, what brings the most joy to your life, other than your family, obviously?
Joy to my life is when I see people going ahead and making a good life for themselves.
Yeah.
I love people who are successful. I really do, and I praise them.
Yeah. Do you have anything that you own, a thing that you own that you truly cherish?
My fishing rods?
You like it?
Yo, I love them. I've got reels for 40 years, 50 years.
Is it?
The little coffee grinders.
Yeah?
And not coffee grinders, record reels. The old fishing rods, remember our record reels? You used to wind the line up and down.
Yeah.
Two handles. That's what I caught my 8.5 kilo fish on.
Jeez.
On a record reel.
Is it?
No drag.
Yeah.
A drag which can't really stop anything, but it was good enough for 7 ounces.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Those days you couldn't get a smooth enough reel like you get today with Shimano's.
Yes.
They're smooth as silk today.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Perfect. All that technology, eh?
Yeah.
Music. You into music? You like dancing, so.
No, no.
Yeah. What's your favorite stuff?
Anything with a beat.
Is it?
That I can dance with.
But what was your first record that you bought when you were younger? Can you remember?
Oh, God, I never bought records.
Didn't you buy Elvis or something?
I used to steal it. No, I'm joking. No, I used to... I was never an Elvis fan. I loved the Beatles. I loved their music. Today, when I hear Elvis... when I hear the Beatles, the best music in the world, man. I've always been a Beatles fan. Elvis never really interested me.
Yeah, and the best of advice that you've ever received?
Teach your children to fish and keep them out the street.
It didn't work, right?
No, keeps them out the street. And
it also bankrupted me, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. What could the young fishermen of today learn from you with from those of you with experience?
Well, if anybody wants to know how to tie a knot in nylon, I will show them knots they've never seen in their life.
Really? So you've got a knot specialist as well, remember?
No, I won a competition in America with knot tying.
I mean, you're talking about one with a 30...
you turn around your finger, it's called a bimini twist, it's a twine like that, but when the fish takes it, stretches like a spring. But I didn't bring one down, I could show them what the spring
does. What's it called?
A bimini twist.
A bimini twist.
The first one they ever did was on Bimini Island, off KK Island.
Yes,
you could see Bimini Island, you could see... Cuba. I said to the guy, can't we go dancing there? He said, yeah, but the girls have been in the sun a long time. I said to the guy in the back, come on, let's go there. We're going to have a couple of drinks.
Cubans are going to do their stuff.
Cubans can dance.
And beautiful buildings in Cuba.
They can
do
the best tangos in the world. Yeah. Comes from Cuba.
Yeah, for sure. And they're that beautiful Art Deco.
I would love to go to Cuba, but we never had a visa.
Okay.
And although we were only 19 miles by boat from Cuba.
Okay, Jesus. Close.
Oh, I would love to have gone there. I wish I applied for a visa. Yeah. Then we could have gone there, but not one of us had a visa.
Well, I think it's time to wrap it up, George. And thank you so much for coming on the show.
Well, it's enjoying my last fishing. I can talk about it all night.
It's been, and Ray, thank you for bringing your dad and chirping in here. It's been fantastic.
And I must thank all you guys who gave me wonderful comments. I love you all. May God bless all of you.
Here we go. What we're going to do is now we're going to give away the prize. I don't know if there's a couple more. Do you want to do some comments? Okay, we'll do the prize quickly. We're going to see who's going to win the competition. So you're going to win the Fitch and Leeds competition. We've got the thing goes around and around and around until we see who's going to win. Lord Death, Alan Carter, Shireen. Shireen is the winner.
Yep.
There we go. She stayed in the same CD.
Excellent, excellent.
Well, well done, Shireen.
Well done, Shireen. And yeah, there's a couple more comments as we go out. Thank you to our sponsors, Fitch and Leeds and Spa. Thank you to Spa, as well as Amobia and Fat Cats. Philippa says, now family, my mom, my aunt and grandma were fishermen. They taught me everything I know about fishing. That's my wife. That's an old Kenton and Kenton. Lucille Tessner saying, how's it? Kate saying, great stories. Thanks, Kate. Well, you got to start fishing now, Kate. And Dagan as well, there as well. Cindy Keats, true legend of fishermen, she says.
Dagan's my other grandson, each other.
There we go. Bonnie Nielsen, that was an amazing story, thank you.
Kate. Bonnie, goodness.
Here we go. And Dave, thank you, Dave. Lucky to have you on as well, buddy. Nice to see that you're still doing well. And we'll check you on Facebook. Jean-Claude Smith says, no, Claudel, she loves you.
My daughter.
Yes,
she looks just like me. She does. You can see me.
Just slightly younger, that's what. Don't look 85 just yet, Claudel. Thanks, guys. And we'll see you on, remember on Thursday, it's John Rushmere. Don't miss out. John Rushmere.
I knew John very well.
Oh, he's a good chap.
I remember when he got married to a Miss P.E.
Oh, yes, Miss Daniel.
And I came to my house where the fish bar.
Nice.
How the fish bar started, I used to catch a lot of shad.
Yeah.
And
relax, sit down. Coming out of P.E. town. Well, drink, find a shark. Never mind your liver. Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Get to Gino's spot.
Gino's spot.
Have a laugh, have a giggle, and exercise your middle. Have a Gino's.